you want us to sort of start eating?
Well, we can do both.
Yeah, just eat as you like.
Is that okay?
So this is, what's the date?
June 23rd.
June 23rd, this is a recording between Julian Assange, Eric Schmidt, and
Lisa Shields,
to be used in a book by Eric Schmidt, due to be published by Knopf in October 2012. I have been given a guarantee that I will see the transcript and will be able to adjust it for accuracy and clarity.
We agree. Can we start? I wanted to talk a little bit about Thor, right? The sort of the whole Navy network and
Thor or Thor?
Actually, Thor.
And Odin as well.
Sorry. Thor. And the Navy network, and I don't actually understand how all of that worked. And the reason I'm interested in this is I'm fundamentally interested in what happens with that technology as it evolves, right? And so the problem, I would assert, is that if you're trying to receive data, you need to have a guarantee of anonymity to the sender, you need to have a secure channel to the recipient, the recipient needs to be replicated, what I'd like you to do, if you could, is talk a little bit about that architecture, what you did in WikiLeaks technically, what were sort of the technical innovations that were needed, and then maybe also what happens, how does it evolve? Technology always evolves.
So let me first frame this. So I looked at something that I had seen going on with the world, which is that I thought that there were too many unjust acts, and I wanted there to be more just acts and fewer unjust acts. And one can sort of say, well, what are your philosophical axioms for this? And I say, I do not need to consider them. This is simply my temperament. And it is an axiom because it exists that way. And so that avoids then getting into further unhelpful philosophical discussion about why you want to do something. So it is enough that I do. So in considering how unjust acts are caused and what tends to promote them and what promotes just acts, I saw that human beings are basically invariant. That is, that their inclinations and biological temperaments hasn't changed much over many thousands of years, and so therefore the only playing field left is what do they have and what do they know. And have is something that is fairly hard to influence. So that is, what resources do they have at their disposal, and what, how much energy they can harness, and what are the food supplies and so on. But what they know can be affected in a non-linear way, because when one person conveys information to another, they can convey it on to another and another and so on in a way that is non-linear, and so you can affect a lot of people with a small amount of information. And therefore you can change the behavior of many people with a small amount of information. So the question then arises as to what kinds of information will produce behavior which is just and disincentivize behavior which is unjust. So all around the world, there are people observing different parts of what is happening to them locally. And there are other people that are receiving information they haven't observed firsthand. And in the middle, there are people who are involved in moving information from the observers to the people who will act on information. And so these are three separate problems that are all coupled together. And I felt that there was a difficulty in taking observations and putting them in an efficient way into a distribution system which could then get this information to people who would act on it. And so you can argue that companies like Google, for example, are involved in this middle business of taking, of moving information from people who have it to people who want it. The problem I saw was that this first step was crippled. And often the last step as well, when it came to information that governments were inclined to censor. So we can look at this whole process as the fourth estate, or justice produced by the fourth estate. And so you have some kind of pipeline, and so I have this description, which is a little bit, which sort of derived from my experiences in quantum mechanics about looking at the flow of particular types of information which will affect some change in the end. So the bottleneck to me appeared to primarily be in the acquisition of information that would go on to produce changes that were just. And in a fourth estate context, the people who acquire information are sources. People who work on information and distribute it are journalists and publishers, and people who act on it is everyone. So that's a high-level construct, but of course it then comes down to practically how do you engineer a system that solves that problem, and not just the technical system, but a total system. So WikiLeaks was and is an attempt, although still very young, at a total system.
For all three phases?
To deal with, not for all three phases, but for the political component, the philosophical component, and the engineering component in getting out that first component. So politically that means anonymizing and protecting, sorry, technically that means anonymizing and protecting sources in a wide variety of ways. Politically, that also means protecting them politically and incentivizing them in a political manner. Saying that their work is valuable and encouraging other people to take it up. And then there's also a legal aspect. So what are the best laws that can be created and the best jurisdictions to operate this sort of stuff from, and practical everyday legal defense. So on the technical front, our first prototype was engineered for a very adverse situation where publishing would be extremely difficult, and our only effective defense in publishing would be anonymity, where sourcing is as difficult as it still currently is for the national security sector, and where internally we had a very small and completely trusted team.
question up here. Publishing means the question of the site itself and making the material public.
Yeah, making the primary source material public.
Yes.
That's what I mean by publishing.
So the first step was to make that done correctly.
It was clear to me that all over the world publishing is a problem. And whether that's through self-censorship or overt censorship.
Is that because of fear of retribution by the governments?
It's mostly self-censorship.
I see.
In fact, I would say it's probably the most significant one historically has been economic censorship, where it's simply not profitable to publish something. There is no market for it. That's probably I just described it as a censorship pyramid. It's quite interesting. So on the top of the pyramid, there are the murders of journalists and publishers. And at the next level, there's legal attacks on journalists and publishers. So if you think, what is a legal attack? A legal attack is simply a delayed use of coercive force, which doesn't necessarily result in murder, but may result in incarceration or asset seizure. So the next level down, and remember the volume, the area of the pyramid, we're talking about proper pyramid, the volume of the pyramid increases significantly as you go down from the peak. And in this example, that means that the number of acts of censorship also increase as one goes down. So there's very few people who are murdered. There's a few people who suffer legal. There's a few number of public legal attacks on individuals and corporations. And then at the next level, there's a tremendous amount of self-censorship. And this self-censorship occurs in part because people don't want to move up into the upper parts of the pyramid. They don't want to come under legal attack and other coercive uses of coercive force, but they also don't want to be killed.
I see.
So that discourages people from behaving a certain way. And then there are other forms of self-censorship that are concerned about missing out on business deals, missing out on promotions, and those are even more significant because they are lower down the pyramid. And the very bottom, which is the largest volume, is all those people who cannot read, do not have access to print, do not have access to fast communications, or where there is no profitable industry in providing that. Okay. So we decided to deal with the top of this censorship pyramid, the top two sections, the threats of violence and the delayed threats of violence that are represented by the legal system. So in some ways, that is the hardest case. In some ways, it's the easiest case. It's the easiest case because it's clear cut when things are being censored there or not. It's also easiest because the volume of censorship is relatively small, even if the per event significance can be very high. So before WikiLeaks had, although of course I had some previous political connections from other activities, we didn't have that many friends. We didn't have significant political allies, and we didn't have a worldwide audience that were looking to see how we were doing. So we took the position that we would need to have a publishing system that its only defense was anonymity. That is, it had no financial defense, it had no legal defense, and it had no political defenses. Its defenses were purely technical. So that meant a system that was well distributed at its front, with many domain names and a fast ability to change those domain names, a caching system, and at the back, tunneling through the Tor network to hidden servers.
So, again, if I could talk to us a little bit about this. So, you can switch the your website names and so forth very quickly. You use the tunneling to get back to communicate among these replicas, or this is for distribution?
So we had sacrificial front nodes that were very, very fast to set up, very quick to set up, that we nonetheless did place in relatively hospitable jurisdictions like Sweden. And those fast front nodes were fast because there was no very few hops between them and the
sure.
and the people reading them.
Yeah.
And that's an important lesson that I had learned from things that I did before, that being a Sherman tank is not always an advantage because you're not maneuverable and you're slow. So a lot of the protection for publishers is publishing quickly. If you get the information out quickly and very well read, the incentive for people to go after you in relation to that specific piece of information is actually zero. There may be incentives for them to go after you to teach a lesson to other people who might defy their authority, or to teach a future lesson to your organization about defiance of authority.
So again, to construct the argument, you were concerned that governments or whatever would attack the front ends of this thing through either denial of service attacks or blocking, you know, basically filtering them out, which is as our succession is commonly done. So an important aspect of this was to always be available.
Always be available in one particular way or another. Now, that's not it's a battle that we have mostly won, but we haven't completely won it. I mean, within a few weeks, the Chinese government had added us to their to their ban list. But we had hundreds of domain names of various sorts, domain names that were registered with very, very large DNS providers. So if there was IP level based filtering, it would whack out another 500,000 domains. So then that would create a political back pressure that would undo it. However, DNS based filtering is still hits us in China, because the most common names, the ones that are closest to WikiLeaks, the name that people can communicate easily, they are all filtered by the Chinese government.
Of course they are.
And any domain with WikiLeaks anywhere in it, no matter where it is filtered. So that means there has to be a variant that they haven't yet discovered. But people, the variant has to be known widely enough for people to go there. So there is a catch-22.
That's a structural problem with the naming of the internet, but the Chinese would simply do content filtering on you.
Well, HTTPS worked for about a year and a half.
Okay.
Worked quite well, actually. And then changing IPs also worked. The Chinese internet filtering system is quite baroque, and they've evolved it, and sometimes they do things manually, and sometimes they do an automated way in terms of adding IPs to the list based upon domain names. And then we had a quite interesting battle where we saw that they were looking up our IPs, and we see that these requests came from a certain DNS block range in China. Whenever we saw that, we just then returned.
That's clever.
has different IPs. I was actually thinking that we could return the public security bureau IPs.
That's funny. This is Jared. Hi, I'm so sorry we're late. Flight delay.
Please meet you.
Awesome. Is it United or was it?
Delta. I'm never flying again.
Yeah, it's Delta.
Hi.
So you're Larry.
Jared.
And this is Scott.
Hi, Scott. Nice to meet you.
Scott is our editor.
Sorry, we're an hour and a half late.
That's all right. It's a beautiful day to drive.
We've actually been having a perfectly wonderful time.
I'm sure.
Anyway, like, Scott sit there and you sit here next to Amy. I don't know where you're sitting. Julian was kind enough, since we did not bring a tape recorder, he's just going to talk to him. This is the first time, I find embarrassing on this stat, that You're asking to interview subject if you could borrow a tape recorder.
a friend of mine did an interview in PG's staff chair, General Rand Booker's coup, where he had General Rand Booker's second in command admit on tape that the CIA had paid him off.
Wow.
And he got back and he was like, yes, this is like story of the decade, and it failed. So I have lots of these. You should always actually have
Always have your own. So for Scott and Jared, we spent a fair amount of time just sort of chatting about Google and what I was up to, introduce Lisa. I failed to properly articulate what a brilliant book we're working on. Lisa assisted me. Julian seemed to be totally okay with her assist. And then what we agreed was that we would talk about technology directions and maybe the implications of all of this. And the deal was that this would be on the record for the book. You would have a transcript prepared, and you would have an opportunity to modify, extend, improve its clarity, which all seemed rather reasonable to me. So we just started. We talked a little bit about that. We talked a little bit about sort of the general principles that he's articulated, and I was just starting to talk a little bit about the structure of why Wikileaks has been architected the way it is. And the rough summary there is that the concern that he had in architecting this was that if you look at the governments, you know, the sort of the stuff that they do, the murder journalists, you know, prison journalists and that kind of stuff, his view was that we want to attack that problem by making a system that was very, very hard to block. Right? So the non-technical explanation of what he did is that he built a system where if they do the obvious things to block them, it can essentially show up in another way. Change its name, have a replica.
The replicating thing is very interesting. We developed internal systems to do some of these fast replicas. Not very, quite unsophisticated, but worked quickly. But I think this is... I've been thinking about this for a while now. I think this... That the naming of things is very important. The naming of human intellectual work and our entire intellectual record is possibly the most important thing. So we all have words for different objects, like tomato, but we use a simple word, tomato, instead of actually describing every little aspect of this goddamn tomato, because it takes too long.
And yeah, that'd be great, thanks.
Because it takes too long to describe this tomato precisely, we use an abstraction so we can think about it and so we can talk about it. And we do that also when we use URLs. Those are frequently used as a short name for some human intellectual content. And we build all our civilization, other than on bricks, on human intellectual content. And so we currently have a system with URLs where the structure we are building our civilization out of is the worst kind of melting plasticine imaginable. And that's a big problem.
And you would argue a different namespace structure should evolve.
Well, I think there's a fundamental confusion and overloading of the current URL idea.
Yeah, absolutely.
So on the one hand, we have live dynamic services and organizations. Well, there's three things. Live dynamic services, organizations that run those services. So you're referring to a hierarchy. You're referring to a system of control. An organization, a government that represents an organized controlling group. And on the other hand, you have artifacts. You have human intellectual artifacts that have the ability to actually be completely independent from any system of human control. They are out there in the platonic realm somehow, and shouldn't in fact be referred to by an organization. They should be referred to in a way that is intrinsic to the intellectual content that arises out of the intellectual content. So actually I think that is an inevitable and very important way forward. And where I saw that this was a problem was dealing with a man by the name of Nahadimi Alchi. So he, a few years ago, was listed by one of the big business magazines in the UK as the fifth richest man in the UK. And he, in 1980, left Iraq. He'd grown rich under Saddam Hussein's oil ministry. And is alleged by the Italian press to be involved in a lot of arms trading there, and has over 200 companies run out of his Luxembourg holding unit, and several that we discovered in Panama. Has infiltrated the British Labour political establishment to the degree that on the 20th business birthday in London, he was given a painting signed by 146 members of Commons, including Tony Blair. He's the same guy who was a principal financier of Tony Rezko. Tony Rezko was the financier and fundraiser of Roy Blagojevich from Chicago, convicted of corruption. Tony Rezko has been convicted of corruption, and Barack Obama. He was the intermediary who helped Barack Obama buy one of his houses and that. Money, not directly for the house, but buoyed up Tony Rezko's finances came from that anyway. So during the 2008 presidential primaries, a lot of attention was turned towards Barack Obama by the US press, unsurprisingly. And so it started to look into who were his fundraisers, discovered Tony Rezko. And then they just started to turn their eyes towards Nahadim Alchi. Alchi then hired Carter Ruck, a rather notorious firm of London libel solicitors, whose founder, Carter Ruck, has been described for doing for freedom of speech what the Boston Strangler did for door-to-door salesmen. And he started writing letters to all the London papers that had records of his 2003 extradition to France and conviction for corruption in France over the Elf Aquitaine scandal, where he had been involved in taking kickbacks on selling the invaded Kuwaiti government's oil refineries. In order to fund their operations, why Iraq had occupied it. So the Guardian pulled three articles from 2003. So they were 5 years old. They'd been on the Guardian's archive for 5 years without saying anything. If you go to those URLs, you will not see removed due to legal threat. You will see page not found. And one from the Telegraph and a bunch from some American publications and bloggers and so on. So actually, important bits of history, recent history, that were relevant to an ongoing presidential campaign in the United States were pulled out of the intellectual record. They're also pulled out of the Guardian's index of articles. So why the Guardian's published in print, and you can go to the library and look up those articles, they're still there in the library. Why? How would you know that they were there in the library to look up? Because they're not there in the Guardian's index. I mean, not only have they ceased to exist, they have ceased to have ever have existed, which is the modern implementation of Orwell's dictum that he who controls the present controls the past, and he who controls the past controls the future, because the past is stored physically in the present, all records of the past. So this issue of preserving politically salient intellectual content while it's under attack is central to what WikiLeaks does, because that's what we're after. We're after those bits that people are trying to suppress, because we suspect, usually rightly, that they're expending economic work on suppressing those bits because they perceive that they're going to induce some change.
But so it's the evidence of the suppression that you look for in order to determine value.
Yeah, that's a very good, not precisely, but it's a very...
Well, tell me precisely.
Well, it's not a precise, it's not always right. Right? It's, right. It's a very suggestive...
It's not perfect.
It's not perfect, but it's a very suggestive signal that the people who know the information best, like the people who wrote it, are spending economic work in preventing it going into the historical record, preventing it going into the public. Why spend so much work doing that? It's more efficient to just let everyone have it. You don't have to spend the time guarding it, but also it's more efficient in terms of your organization, because all the positive unintended consequences of the information going around can come out. So
No, I want water, but Eric took mine.
So we selectively come up with that. So we selectively go after that information, and that information is selectively suppressed inside organizations, and very frequently, if it's a powerful group, as soon as someone tries to publish it, it is also suppressed.
So just to, I want to tell a little bit more about the technology. So in this structure, you could put up a new front end very quickly, and you have stored replicas that are distributed. One of the questions is, how do you decide which ISPs?
Okay, that's a very good question.
Yeah, it's a pretty complicated set of questions.
Yeah. So I'll give you an example about how not to choose them. So we dealt with a case in the Turks and Caicos Islands where there was a great little group called the TCI Journal, Turks and Caicos Islands Journal, which is sort of a best use case for the internet. So who are they? Well, they're a bunch of political reformers, ecologically minded people in the Turks and Caicos Islands who live there, who saw that overseas property developers were coming in and somehow getting crown land very cheaply, and building big high rises on it and so on. So they were campaigning for good governments and trying to expose these people. It's like a classic best use case for the internet. Cheap publication means that you can have many more types of publishers, which means you can have self-subsidizing publishers. So you can have people that are able to publish purely for their ideological reasons or for altruistic reasons, because the cost of altruism in relation to publishing are not so high, you can't do it. So they were handed out of the Turks and Caicos Islands pretty quickly, and they moved their servers to India. The Turkish property developer that they had been busy exposing then hire correspondent lawyers in London who hired correspondent lawyers in India who handed them out of their ISP there. They moved to Malaysia. They got handed out, same deal there, the ISP. They became non-profitable to the ISP as soon as the legal letters started coming in. They went to the US, and once they're in the US, the US ISP didn't bolt. They picked one that was a bit better, didn't collapse as fast. However, they noticed that they were using a Gmail address, and the editors were anonymous because of the threats. Who was the responsible party was anonymous, although their columnists often weren't. And so they filed suit in California. And as part of filing suit, they started issuing subpoenas. They issued a subpoena on Gmail. And the result was that Gmail, Google told them that they had to come to California to defend, otherwise everything would be handed over. These are little guys in the Turks and Caicos Islands trying to stop corruption in their country against a property value of hundreds of millions. How can they go to California to fight off a libel suit with fight off a subpoena, which is part of a bogus libel suit? So, well, of course they can't. But we managed to arrange some lawyers for them, and they just happened to be a nice little bit of the California statute code that addressed this precise situation, which is when someone publishes something and you then issue a subpoena to try and get their identity. You can't do it and you've got to pay costs. So that was just that was a nice little legal hook that someone had introduced. And Google didn't send any lawyers to help them either.
Industry, I would guess. The entertainment industry in California.
But I don't know. Anyway. So that's an example of what happens. If you're pretty bright guys, actually, they had a good Indian technical guy. They had bright political guys. You've got a decent technical guy. You've got decent political guys. You come together to try and fix corruption in your country using the internet as your publishing mechanism. What happens? You are hounded from one end of the earth to the other. And then these guys were lucky enough that they had enough resources that they could survive this hounding. And they ended up finding some friends and settling into a position where they arrived. So for us, this was a matter of looking at what ISPs had survived pressure, but also because I was connected to this world of politics and technology and anti-censorship for a long time, I sort of knew some of the players. So we had friends at ISPs within the ISPs that, if you like, we had already ideologically infiltrated. So we knew that they would fight in our corner if there was a request come in. We knew there was a decent chance that if subpoenas were served, even ones that had gag orders on them, we'd still find out about it. So how can someone do it who's not in that world? Well, the answer is not easily. You can look at ISPs that Wikileaks has used, or is currently using, is probably a better version of this, or that the Pirate Bay has used, or other groups that are tremendously under attack. In the case of the little ISP, and it is often a little ISP that is like this. In the case of little ISP, PRQ in Sweden, that was founded by Gottfried, who's pseudonym is Anna Carter. He's one of the technical brains behind the Pirate Bay. So they had developed a niche industry, also along with Barnhoff, a bigger ISP in Sweden, of dealing with refugee publishers, and that is the correct word for it, the correct phrase for it, that there are publishing refugees. So they had, at that time, other than us, Malaysia Today, which had to flee. Sorry, not Malaysia Today. The American Homeowners Association, which had to flee from property developers in the United States. The Kavat Center, so a Caucasus News Center, which is constantly under attack by the Russians. In fact, a PRQ was raided several times by the Swedish government after leverage from the Russian government. The Rick Ross Institute on Destructive Cults was Mr. Malcomson, American-based outfit, had been sued out of America by Scientology and so on. So in Malaysia today, run by a wonderful guy by the name of Roger Petra, who has two arrest warrants out for him in Malaysia. He has fled to London, but his servers can't survive in London. They're in Singapore in the United States.
But again, that's a means of other sites that participate in this.
Yes, so we have some 1,400, but those are, we have mirrors that are voluntary as well as...
So those are basically just opt-in mirror sites,
yeah.
Right?
They determine their own risks. We don't know about them. We can't guarantee they're at all trustworthy, okay, etc. But they do increase the numbers.
And when you've been quoted in the press as saying that there's a much larger store of information that's encrypted and distributed... Is it distributed in those sorts of places?
No, that's an open. We openly distribute backups of encrypted backups of materials that we view that are highly sensitive, that we are to publish in the coming year.
Okay.
Not as some people have said. So we have a thermonuclear device to use on our opponents, but rather so that there is very little possibility that material, even if we are completely wiped out,
yes,
will be taken from the historical record.
And eventually you'll reveal the keys necessary to decrypt.
No, ideally we will never reveal the key. Because there's things like, so redactions sometimes need to be done on this material.
Yes,
so it's, our view is that the material is so significant that even if we release it as is, with no redactions, that the benefits would outweigh the harm. But through redacting things, we can get the harm down even more.
Yeah, and I understand that. One more sort of technical question about the front end. So my simple explanation is that the tools will get better for an anonymous sender to send to a distrustful recipient, and then this anonymous you're describing, and that it'll get to the point where there'll be a very large amount of people using such services for all sorts of reasons.
Yes.
You know, truthful, lying, manipulation, what have you. The current technology you used, basically had FTP files sent to you. Right? Basically, people will FTP something and just sort of ship it to you.
No, we have. We have lots of different paths, and that's quite deliberate. And we don't say which one is used more than which other one, because it means investigative resources have to be spread across all possible paths. But they are from in person, in the mail. Postal mail is still actually pretty good if you want to send anonymous stuff. Encrypt something to a key if you think it might be intercepted on the way. Send it from somewhere, it's still pretty good. Straight HTTPS uploads, although they're not actually sort of straight, but to the user that looks like they're straight. Behind the scenes, all sorts of other stuff is going on. The biggest problem with computer security is not communication, it's endpoints. And so dealing with endpoint attacks, both on someone trying to send us information, and more importantly, because if someone trying to send us information is compromised, that's one compromise of one person. If our engine that receives information is compromised, that's a potential compromise of every person that's trying to send us material.
I guess I didn't ask my question quite right. Is there some new technology which, in your view, is going to materially change this sort of simple model that I have about there'll be a vast increase of
this? Yes. So
what are those technologies?
The most important one is naming things properly. If we are able to name some... a video file or a piece of text in a way that is intrinsically coupled to the information there. There's no ambiguity. So a hash is an example of this. But then there's some variants. Maybe you want a one that you human beings can actually remember. Then it permits this information to be spread in such a way where you don't have to trust the underlying networks, and you can flood it.
Why do you not have to trust?
Well, because you can sign the hashes.
So you sign the name as well as the content.
You can just sign the hash.
Right, sign the hash.
And that's the hash. If the name is like a hash,
yeah, then it's completely, it's unambiguous as to what
it's unambiguous. Yeah.
So you're basically saying you have a provable name.
Yeah.
As opposed to an alterable name.
Yeah. Okay. And those sorts of mechanisms are evolving now. So we've been using something like this internally, and I've been writing a paper on to try and make this a standard for everyone. But you can see that they are actually evolving. So if we look at magnet links, have you seen these? So in BitTorrent, there's a sort of enhancement of BitTorrent, which is a magnet link. And a magnet link is actually a hash. So it is hash addressing. It doesn't point to any particular server. Rather, there's a big hash tree and a distributed hash tree over, I don't know how technical I can get.
Please.
There's a big distributed hash tree over many millions of computers involved in the hash tree. And many, many entry points into this hash tree. So it is very hard to censor. And the addressing for content is on the hash of the content. And
right, yeah, so you're basically using the hash as the address, and you do the addressing within the namespace to provide it. So you, as long as you have assigned...
as long as you get the hash.
You can't hide it.
Well, there's a question as to, you've got a name for something, you've got a hash, but what does that tell you? Nothing, really, because it's not really human readable. So you need another mechanism to get the fact that that's important to you.
Sure.
And that is something like WikiLeaks signs that and says that that is
an interesting piece of
information. We have verified that it is true. So, but that for once you feed that information into the system, then it becomes very unclear how it got into that system, or how you get rid of it from the system. And if you do get rid of it, if someone does manage to get rid of it, you know for sure that it's been gotten rid of, because the hash doesn't resolve to anything anymore. Similarly, if someone were to modify it, the hash changes.
I was going to say, why wouldn't they just rename it rather than...
They can't, because the name is intrinsically coupled to the intellectual content.
I think the way to explain this, to summarize the technical idea, is take all the content of the document, come up with a number. So if the content is gone, the number doesn't show anything. And if the content has changed, the number doesn't compute right anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So it's an interesting property.
So
how far are we from this type of system being deployable?
On the publishing end, the magnet links and so on are starting to come up. There's also a very nice little paper that I've seen in relation to Bitcoin. Do you know about Bitcoin? Okay, so Bitcoin is something that evolved out of the cypherpunks a couple of years ago. And so it's an alternative, it's a stateless currency.
Yeah, I was reading about it just yesterday.
And very important, actually. It has a few problems, but its innovations exceed its problems. Now, there's been innovations along these lines in many different paths of digital currencies, anonymous, untraceable, etc. That people have been experimenting with over the past 20 years. But Bitcoin actually has the balance and incentives right, and that's why it started to take off. The different combinations of things. No central nodes, it's all point-to-point. One does not need to trust any central mint. So if we look at traditional currencies such as gold, we can see they have some interesting properties that make them valuable as a medium of exchange. So gold is divisible. It's easy to chop up. In fact, out of all metals, it's the easiest to chop up into fine segments. You can test whether, relatively easily, whether it's true or whether it's fake. You can take chopped up segments and you can put them back together by melting the gold. So that's what makes it a good medium of exchange. And it's also a good medium of value store, because you can take it and put it in the ground and it's not going to decay like apples or steaks. So the problems with traditional digital currencies on the internet is that you have to trust the mint not to print too much of it. And the incentives for the mint to keep printing are pretty high, actually, because you can print free money. And that means you need some kind of regulation. And if you have some kind of regulation, then who's going to enforce the regulation? So now all of a sudden you've sucked in the whole problem of the state into this issue and political pushes here and there, and who can get control of the mint and push it one way or another for their particular purposes. So Bitcoin instead has an algorithm where the where anyone can be their own mint. So they're basically just searching for collisions with hashes. So a simple way, they're searching for a sequence of zero bits on the beginning of the thing. And you have to randomly search multiple hashes to do this. There's a lot of computational work to do this. And each Bitcoin software that is distributed, that work algorithmically increases as time goes by. So the difficulty in producing Bitcoins becomes harder and harder and harder. That's built into the system. Just like the difficulty in mining gold becomes harder and harder and harder. And that's what makes people predict that there's not going to be a sudden amount of gold in the market. Rather,
to enforce scarcity.
Right, enforce scarcity, and the scarcity will go up as time goes by. And what does that mean for incentives in going into the Bitcoin system? That means that you should get into the Bitcoin system now, early. You should be an early adopter because your Bitcoins are going to be worth a lot of money one day. So once you have and the Bitcoins are just a Bitcoin address, is just a big hash. It's a hash of a public key that you generate. So once you have this hash, you can just advertise it to everyone and people can send you Bitcoins. And there's people that have set up exchanges to go from Bitcoin to US dollars and so on. It solves a very interesting technical problem, which is how do you stop double spending? And so if all digital material can be cloned for almost zero cost. So if you have currency as a digital string of numbers, how do you stop me knowing I want to buy this piece of pasta? Here's a digital currency, and now I take a copy of it, and now I want to buy your bit of egg. And then you go, and now I want to buy your radish, and you go, what? I've already got that. You know, what's going on here? There's been some fraud committed here. So there's a synchronization problem, actually. Who now has the coin? And so there's a point-to-point spread network with all these problems of some parts of the network being faster, some points being slower, multiple paths of communication. How do you solve this synchronization issue? About who has the currency. And so this is, to my mind, actually the real technical innovation in Bitcoin, that it has done this using some hash trees and then a delayed time, and the CPU work has to be done in order to move one thing to a net to another, so information can't spread too fast. Okay, so once you have a system of currency that is easy to use like that, then you can start to use it for things that you want to be scarce. So what is an example of some things we want to be scarce? Well, domain names. Names. We want names to be scarce. We want short names to be scarce. Otherwise, if they're not scarce, it doesn't take work to get them. As soon as you have a nice naming system, some asshole is going to come along and register every short name for themselves. So this Bitcoin replacement for DNS is precisely what I wanted and what I was theorizing about, which is not a DNS system, but rather short name, short bit of text to long bit of text, tuple registering service. Because that is the abstraction of domain names and all these problems, is you have something that you want to register that is short, and you want to couple that to something that is unmemorable or longer. So, for example, the First Amendment, that phrase, the US First Amendment, that's a very short phrase, but it expands to a longer bit of text. So you take the hash of this text, and now you've got something that's intrinsically coupled to that, that's unmemorable, can't memorize it. But then you can register US First Amendment coupled to the hash. And that then means you have a structure where you can tell whether something has been published or unpublished. You can, one piece of human intellectual information can cite another one in a way that is, I'm sort of, can't be manipulated. And if it is censored, the censorship can be found out. And if one place is censored, well, you can scour the entire world for this hash, and no matter where you find it, you know it is what you wanted precisely. Right. So that, in theory, then it permits human beings to build up an intellectual scaffold where every citation, every reference to some other part of human intellectual content is precise and can be discovered if it exists out there anywhere at all, and it's not dependent on any particular organization. So as a way of publishing, this seems to be the most censorship resistant manner of publishing possible, because it is not dependent on any particular mechanism of publishing. You could be publishing through the post, you could be publishing on conventional websites, you could be publishing using BitTorrent, you could be publishing using whatever, but the naming is consistent. And same for publishing is also a matter of transferring. I mean, you can, all you then have to do is, if you want to transfer something anonymously to someone else, one particular person, you encrypt the information with their key, and you publish it.
Are you worried, this entire system depends on basically revocable and irrevocable key structures, are you worried that the key structures will fall apart?
Well, the hashing, in terms of the naming part, going to hashes, it doesn't depend on the key structure at all. In terms of Bitcoin has its own key structure, and that's an independent thing. There's all sorts of problems with that. Hackers can come in and steal keys, etc. They're the same problems that you have with cash. Armored vans are needed to protect the cash, etc. And there's some enhancements you can use to try and remove the incentives a bit one way or another. For example, you could introduce a sub-currency with fixed periods of spends. So you can retract for 1 week or 1 day, and a merchant will accept or not accept.
But the average person doesn't understand that when RSA was broken into, an awful lot of very important keys involving commerce were taken, presumably, by the Chinese. Yep. So
the public key structure is a tremendous problem. In the same way that domain name structure is a tremendous problem. I mean, the browser-based public keying system that we have for authenticating what websites you're going to, it is awful. It is truly awful. The number of people that have been licensed to mint keys is so tremendous. There's ones that have gone bankrupt and been bought up cheap by Russian companies. We can assume, I have been told actually, that VeriSign, by people who are in the know, although I'm not yet willing to put on the public record, because I've only had one source. You know, just between you and me, I have one source that says that VeriSign has actually given keys to the US government. So, not all, but just particular case. So that's a big problem with the way things are authenticated presently. I mean, there are some traditional alternative approaches, like PGP has a web of trust. I don't think those things really work. What I think does work is something close to what SSH does, and that's probably the way forward, which is it is opportunistic key registration. So as part of your interaction, the first time you interact,
you register the keys.
And then if you have a few points of keying and some kind of flood network, then you can see that, well, lots of people have seen that key many times in the past.
So I have one more sort of technical question, and I think we should probably, and Scott, I think you were sort of
I'm ready.
When we were sort of chatting initially, we talked about sort of my idea that empowering mobile phones being empowered is sort of changing society. Your rough summary of your answer for everybody else was that people are pretty much the same, and something big has to change their behavior. This might be one of them. And you said that you were very interested in somebody building in phone-to-phone encryption. Can you talk a little bit about roughly the architecture where you'd have a broad open network and you have person-to-person encryption? What does that mean technically? How does it work? Why is it important? That kind of stuff. I think people don't understand any of this area.
When we were dealing with Egypt, we saw the Mubarak government cut off the internet, and we saw only there was one ISP that quite a few of us were involved in trying to keep its connections open. It had 6% of the market. Eventually, the Mubarak government also cut off the mobile phone system. And why is it that can be done? People with mobile phones have a device which can communicate in the radio spectrum. In a city, they're high density. There's always, if you like, a path between one person and another person. That is, there's always a continuous path of mobile phones, each one of which can, in theory, hear the radio of the other.
Could form a peer-to-peer network.
So in theory, you could form a peer-to-peer network. Now, the way most GSM phones are being constructed and others is that they receive on a different frequency to which they transmit.
Yes.
And that means that they cannot form peer-to-peer networks. They have to go through base stations. But we are seeing now that mobile phones are becoming more flexible in terms of base station programming. They need to do this because they operate in different markets that have different frequencies. They have different forms of wireless output. And so, and also, even if there's not sufficiently flexible mobile phones, we are seeing that in the mobile phone aspect, maybe WiMAX is coming along, which will give them greater radius for two-way communications. But also, it's getting very cheap to make your own base station. There's software now which will run a base station for you. So you can throw these things up and make your own networks with conventional mobile phones pretty quickly. In fact, this is what is done to spy, cheap spying on mobile phones, as you set up a fake base station. And there's vans now, and you can buy these in bulk on the commercial spy market to go and set up a van and intercept mobile phone calls. So during these revolutionary periods, the people involved in the revolution have to be able to communicate. And if they need to be able to communicate in order to plan quickly and also to communicate information about what is happening in the environment quickly, so they can dynamically adapt to it and produce the next strategy. So where you only have the security services being able to do this, you've turned the mobile phone system off, the security services have such a tremendous advantage compared to people that are trying to oppose them. If you have a system where individuals are able to communicate securely and robustly, despite what security services are doing, then security services have to give more ground. It's not that the government's necessarily going to be overthrown, but rather they have to make more concessions.
They have their network. So you're arguing that even with existing phones, they could be modified to have peer-to-peer encrypted tunnels for voice and data, presumably.
Voice is a bit harder. What we did in internally in this prototype I designed was which only works for medium-sized groups. It's sort of a peer-to-peer flood UDP encrypted network. UDP permits you to put lots and lots of cover traffic in because you can send stuff to random internet hosts.
This is clever. So that way you can't be blocked, right?
Yeah.
Because UDP is a single packet, right?
Yeah. So you send it to random internet hosts, and a random internet host doesn't respond, which is exactly the same thing as a host that is receiving stuff. You can even structure, and using this, you can do hole punching through firewalls. It means that normal at-home people can use this. They don't need to have a server. And it's very light bandwidth, so you can put on mobile phones as well. So the sort of the killer application is not lots of voice, rather it is chat rooms. Small chat rooms of 30 to 100 people. That is what revolutionary movements need. And they need it to be secure, and they need to be robust. And the system I did was protocol independent. So yes, you've got your encapsulating thing, UDP or whatever. In theory, you could be pushing it over SMS, you could be pushing it over TCP, you could be pushing it whatever. You could be using a mobile phone, you could be using a desktop, etc. So if you can put that into one big mesh, then all you need, even when the whole country is shut off, you just need one satellite connection out. And your internal network is then connected to the rest of the world. And if you've got a good routing system, so if it's a small network, you can use flood, and thereby a flood network takes every possible path, therefore must take the fastest possible path. Yeah. So a flood network will always find a way, but doesn't scale to large quantities. But if you've got a good routing system, you just need this one link out. And in Cairo, we had people who hacked Toyota in Cairo and took over their satellite uplink and use that to connect to this ISP that fed 6% of the market. And so that sort of thing was going on all this time. There was a hacker war in Egypt to try and keep this, right to call it a radical, but this more independent ISP that provided 6% of the market up and going. But it shouldn't have been so hard. It should have been the case that all you need to do is just have one connection, and then the most important information could get out. And if you look at, if this is equivalent to SMSs, I mean, look how important Twitter is, look how important SMSs. Actually, human beings are pretty good at encoding the most important thing that's happening into a short amount of data. There's not that many human beings. There just aren't that many. So actually,
it's not a bandwidth problem.
Yeah, it's not a bandwidth problem. So all you need is one pipe, and you can connect a country that's in a revolutionary state to the rest of the world, and points within that country, just as important cities within that country. And it's not that hard a thing to do, quite frankly.
Scott, I think one of...
It's hard to stop. It's so interesting.
I actually have like 5 hours more time.
I know, because it's like one thing, and then there's like more. It's, no, I don't
how
know.
How would you architect this? How would you architect that?
Yeah.
I think my summary would be this notion of a hash ID of the name is a very interesting one, because I had not linked it to Bitcoin. That kind of approach, that scarcity. That's a new idea for me. Have you published that idea?
I've published, not the link to Bitcoin.
Okay.
That paper that came out about coupling something to Bitcoin was just trying to address the DNS issue. But fortunately, the guy who did it understood that why just have quartets, you know, why limit it to IP addresses? Was this sort of natural in the way it decodes the thing to have it go to any sort of expansion? But the idea for there should be this naming system, the importance of this naming system, the importance of preserving history and doing these scaffolds and that Nahdi Miauchi thing. Yeah, so that's on the site under the hands. I think it's part one of the hands of work interview.
Okay. I think we should study this quite a bit more, and maybe we have a few more questions about it. The other comment I would make is that on the assumption that you're describing is going to happen, it's probable that the incentive pressure you're describing.
I've had these ideas several years, but now I see that other people are also getting
there's enough people who are interested in solving the problem we're trying to solve that. On the internet, you know, you tend to see a lot of experience with it. What I'm trying to think is, how would I attack it? How would I attack your idea technically? And I still think I would go after the signing and the key infrastructure.
Well, it's different parts. There's different parts of the idea. So, if you publish some information, or if you spread some information, this publishing thing is quite interesting as to whether when something's gone from not being published to being published is quite interesting. So if you spread some information and you call it well labeled using a hash. That hash is important is something that has to spread in another way. So that's, say, by Wikileaks signing the hash. But there's many ways for it to spread. I mean, people could be swapping that hash in email, they could be telling each other on telephone, etc.
You're saying that all of these systems do not have a single point of attack. I can break down your HTTPS, but you can still use the US Postal Service to send.
Exactly. Right. And you would know that you were getting the right thing because of this naming is completely accurate.
I'm just wondering sort of on the human side of this. I mean, you have such experience of the world that you described earlier. I've only had 3 hours of sleep, so forgive me if I don't remember exactly what you said. But the combination of technical and, you know, altruistic people, I mean, what amounts to a kind of subculture that you've been involved in for, you know, 15 years now. So you know how that subculture works, and that subculture needs to either sort of, I guess, stay the same or expand in order to do the work that you're describing. And so since our book is about
it's dramatically
what
expanded.
Are the patterns there in terms of the people part rather
yeah,
than
so that's, I mean, that's the most optimistic thing that is happening, is the radicalization of internet educated youth. So people who are receiving their values from the internet and giving them back, and then as they find them to be compatible, echoing them back. The echo back is now so strong that it drowns the original statements completely. So there's, I mean, the people that I've dealt with in the 1960s radicals who helped liberate Greece and these sorts of things, dealt with Salazar, they are saying there is nothing at this moment in time is most similar to what happened in this period, these liberation movements in the 1960s, that they have seen.
And
as far as what has entered into the West, because there's certain regions of the world I'm unaware of, but as far as I'm aware that, and of course I wasn't alive in the 1960s, but as far as I can tell, that statement is true. That actually this is the political education of apolitical technical people. is extraordinary in the same way that
people
are going from young people
right.
who are going from apolitical to political.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very, very interesting transition mm-hmm. to see.
And how do you think, since this is your world, I mean, how... Well, why do you think that took place? I mean, why do you think it took place?
Fast communication, critical mass of young people, newer generation. And then some catalyzing events. So the attack on us was a catalyzing event. And our defense was, and our success in defending was a catalyzing event. I don't know, do you remember the PGP case and that grand jury, Zimmerman's one? I wrote half a book on that. It was never published because my co-writer had children. Said multiple copies.
I know exactly.
Your reflexes are really.
I'm just tired of typing anyway.
How did you save whatever you were?
Yeah,
save.
It is in the name tree. Everything goes wrong.
Yeah. Do you see how fast he moves? I was like an impulse.
I know. No, I almost feel like you were there before the computer. You could have got one on it. Computers are important.
That was smooth. Thank you.
But so you're saying, but young people aren't inherently good, and I say that as a father and with regret.
Oh no, I think that actually, well, I've seen Lord of the Flies. I went to 30 schools, so I've seen plenty of Lord of the Flies situations. But I think that the instincts human beings have are actually much better than the societies that we have. I'm not going to say the governments, actually. The whole structure of the society, the economic structure. And that people learn that actually simple altruistic acts don't pay off. They see that some people who are acting non-altruistic ways end up getting Porsches and fast cars, and it tends to pull people in that direction. I thought about this a while ago when I saw there's this fantastic video that came out of Stanford in about 69 of nucleosynthesis of DNA. Have you seen it? It's on YouTube, very wonderful thing. So it's explaining nucleosynthesis through interpretive dance. And so there's like 130 Stanford students out there pretending to be DNA, another pretending, a whole bunch pretending to be a ribosomal subunit and da 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 da. And all wearing the hippie clothes of the day. But they're all actually very black people. So, and I looked at that and thought, could Stanford, and it was a very big, very good bit of education. So it's not that it was cool and unusual, rather it was actually extremely instructive. And before computer animation actually was the best representation of how a ribosomal unit behaves. Could you see Stanford doing that now? Absolutely impossible. It is far too conservative for it to do that now, even though that was an extremely effective bit of education. You can bet everyone who was in that dance remembers exactly how nucleosynthesis occurs, because they all had to remember their parts. And I remember it, having seen it. No, rather that period of peak earnings for average wage in the United States was, what, 77? That certain things simply happened. That those people who altruistic and not too concerned about finances and fiscalization, simply lost power relative to those people who are more concerned about finances and fiscalization and work their way up in the system. So certain behaviors were disincentivized and others were potentiated. And that is primarily, I believe, as a result of technology that enables fiscalization. So fast bank transfers, the IRS being able to account for lots of people, it sucks people into a very rigid fiscalized structure. So you can have a lot of political change in the United States, but will it really change that much? Will it change the amount of money in someone's bank account? Will it change contracts? Will it void contracts that already exist, and contracts on contracts and contracts on contracts and contracts? Not really. So actually, I say that free speech in many places, in many Western places, is free not as a result of liberal circumstances in the West, but rather as a result of such intense fiscalization that it doesn't matter what you say, i.e. the dominant elite doesn't have to be scared of what people thinks, because a change in political view is not going to change whether they own their company or not. It is not going to change whether they own a piece of land or not. But China is still a political society, although it is rapidly heading towards a fiscalized society. And other societies, like Egypt was still heavily politicized. And so their rulers really do need to be concerned about what people think. And so they spend apportionate efforts on controlling freedom of speech.
Anyway, so
I think young people actually have fairly good values. Of course, it's a spectrum and so on, but they actually have fairly good values most of the time, and they want to demonstrate them to other people. And you can see this in when people first go to university and so on, and they become hardened as a result of certain things having a payoff and other things not having a payoff. Studying for an exam constantly, even though in some cases the work is completely mindless and pointless, has a payoff at the end of the year, but going and talking to someone doing a favor doesn't have a payoff at the end of the year. And so it just disincentivize some behaviors, incentive other.
But let me tease out of this a little bit. I mean, it sounds like you've got a view of the globe with certain societies where the impact of technology is relatively slight, certain societies where politically the impact of technology can be quite great, and certain societies where it would be in a sort of middling way, and you would put China into the, I guess, the middling category.
It's starting to be.
It's all about technology and social transformation 10 years down the line. What's the globe that you see given the structure you're describing?
I'm not sure with the impact on China. It is still a political society, so the impact could be very great. I mean, I often say that censorship is always cause for celebration. It is always an opportunity because it reveals fear of reform. It means that the power position is so weak that you've got to care what people think.
Right. It's like you find the sensitive documents by watching them hunt.
Exactly.
This is a very smart.
Sorry, I didn't hear
it. So when the Chinese express all this energy on censoring and all these novel ways, do we say that it's a complete waste of time and energy, or do they have a whole bunch of experience managing the country and understand that it matters what people think? I say it's much more reasonable to interpret it as that different groups, different actors within China who are able to control that censorship system understand correctly that their power position is weak and they need to be careful what people think, so they have to censor.
So the state's rational, at least in its repression.
I'm always worried about talking about the state because it's all individuals acting in their own perceived interests, some this group or that group.
Fair enough.
You know, even the censors in China, the Public Security Bureau, and people below them. Why do they censor stuff, and what do they censor first? I'll tell you what they censor first. They censor first the thing that someone in the Politburo might see. That's what they censor first. They're not actually concerned about darknets. They're not concerned about darknets.
Oh, okay.
Because their bosses can't see what's on the darknet, and so they can't be blamed for not censoring it. We had this fantastic case here in the UK. We got a whole bunch of classified documents from the UK military, and published a bunch. And then later on, we did a sort of preemptive FOI, which we do occasionally on various governments where we can. So we did it on the UK Ministry of Defence, just to see whether they were doing some investigation, just sort of a source protection thing to understand what's going on. And so we got back they pretended not to give us any documents, then we appealed, then we got back a bunch of documents. And so it showed that someone in there had spotted that there was a bunch of UK military documents on our website about their surveillance program, another 2,000-page document about how to stop things leaking, and that their number one threat to the UK military was investigative journalists. Mm-hmm. So that had gone into some counterintelligence da-da-da-da-da, and they were like, oh my god, there's hundreds of pages, and it's about all sorts of countries, and it just keeps going, it's endless, five exclamation marks. And then it's like, okay, so that's the discovery phase. Now, the what is to be done phase. What is to be done? BT has the contracts for the MOD. They told BT to censor us from them. So everyone in the UK MOD could no longer read what was on WikiLeaks. Problem solved.
Interesting.
It's like their generals and their bosses and all these people could no longer see that we had MOD stuff on there. And so now there's no more complaints and their problem is solved. Mm. So some understandings like this might be quite advantageous to use in some of these systems. So it means that darknets, for example, if you understand the bureaucratic structures that employ people and give tasks, always have that sort of thing going on, then that means darknets are going to have a pretty easy time of it until they're so big that they're not darknets anymore.
That's really, really interesting. You mentioned investigative journalism. You've had a lot of experience with journalism by now in many different respects. I mean, how do you see the kind of freeing of information that you were describing earlier as fitting into journalistic processes, if at all, or is it replacing it?
No, it is. It's more how does journalistic processes fit into something that is much bigger. Mm-hmm. And the much bigger thing is that we as human beings shepherd and create our intellectual history as a civilization. Right? And it is that intellectual history on the shelf that we can pull off to do stuff and not do the dumb thing again. Because someone already said that it was dumb and they wrote about their experience, so we don't do it again. And so there are several different processes that are creating that record, and other processes where people are trying to destroy bits of that record, and others that are trying to prevent people putting things into the record. But we all live off that intellectual record. So what we want to do is get as much into the record, prevent as much as possible being deleted from the record.
Right.
And then have the record as searchable as possible.
But one consequence of this view is that actors will find the generation of very large amounts of misinformation strategic for them.
Yeah. Yeah. So this is another type of censorship that I have thought about but don't speak so much about, which is censorship through complexity.
And find it too complicated.
Yeah, and that is basically the offshore financial sector. Is censorship through complexity. Mm-hmm. Censorship of what? Censorship of political outrage. They're not political outrage, there's law reform. There's law reform, you can't do it anymore. So why is it that all these careful tax structuring arrangements are so complex? I mean, they may be perfectly legal, but why are they so goddamn complex? Well, because the ones that weren't complex were understood, and the ones that were understood were regulated. So you're only left with the things that are incredibly complex.
More noise, less signal.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
But how in the future will people deal with the fact that the incentive to publish information that's misleading, wrong, manipulative is very high, and furthermore, you can't figure out who the bad publisher was as well as the...
You know, so
because there's anonymity in the system.
Well, the way it is right now is, first you have to understand, the way it is right now is very bad. This friend of mine, Greg Mitchell, wrote a book about the mainstream media, So Wrong for So Long. And that's basically it. That, yes, we have these heroic moments with Watergate and Bernstein, but actually, come on. It's never been very good. It's always been very bad. And these fine journalists are an exception to the rule. And, you know, when you're, especially when you're involved in something yourself and you know every facet of it, and you look to see what is reported by it in the mainstream press, and you can see naked lies after naked lies that you know that the journalist knows is a lie. It's not a simple mistake. And then simple mistakes, and then people repeating lies and so on. That actually the condition of the mainstream press now is so appalling. I actually don't think it can be reformed. I don't think that's possible. I think it has to be eliminated and replaced with something that's better.
Which does seem to be happening.
Yes. Yes. And I think things like, you know, I've been pushing this idea of scientific journalism that things must be precisely cited in the original source. As much of it is possibly available should be put in the public domain so people can look at it. And just like in science, so you can sort of test to see whether the conclusion comes from the experimental data. Otherwise, you probably just made it up. You could have just made it up. In fact, that's what happens all the time. People just make it up. And they make it up to such a degree that we are led to war. In most wars in the 20th century have started as a result of lies, amplified and spread by the mainstream press. You go, well, that's a horrible circumstance. That's terrible that all these wars start with lies. And I say, no, this is a tremendous opportunity because it means that populations basically don't like wars and they have to be lied into it. And so, and if that means we can be truthed into peace. And so that's an extremely optimistic thing. But this, how do you distinguish publishers, truthful publishers, untruthful publishers? This is a reputational business. And so what I would like is that part of that reputational business, like in science, where's your data? You're not providing your data. Why the hell should I take this seriously? Is that now that we can publish on the internet, now that there is physically room for data, in a newspaper there's not physically room for the primary source, now there's physically room for the primary source, it should be there, and we should create a standard that it should be there. And sure, people can deviate from this standard, but then, well, you're deviating from the standard. If you can't be bothered providing us with the primary source data, why should we pay any attention to what you're writing? You're not treating your reader with respect. It's not falsifiable, therefore... Therefore, pay no attention to it. But the issue of reputation, I guess that's an important issue, actually. How do things have reputation? Well, part of the ways that they have reputation is by this coupling of something happens, someone else says something about it, someone else says something about that, etc. And this is this series of citations as information flows from one person to another and they augment it and so on. And for that to be strong, you need this naming system where what you're relying on is not some startup website that disappears tomorrow or some company that didn't like it and has modified it or it's been sued out of existence. So that, I think, would help with reputation. Complexity is harder. I think that is a big problem. So, when things become open, they start to become more complex because people start hiding what they're doing, their bad behavior, through complexity. And so that will be bureaucratic doublespeak as an example. You know, when things get bureaucratized and everything becomes mealy-mouthed and so on. So that's a cost of openness, is that kind of bureaucratization. And the offshore sector, you see incredible complexity in the layers of things happening to each other, so they become impenetrable. And of course, cryptography is a intellectual system which has specialized in making things as complex as possible. Those things that are hard to attack, on the other hand, complex systems are also hard to use. So bureaucracies and internal communications systems which have this that are full of weasel words and are ass covering are inefficient internal communication systems. And similarly, those tremendously complex offshore structuring arrangements are actually inefficient. So maybe you're ahead when the tax regime is high, but if the tax regime was zero, you're not going to be ahead at all.
Right.
Well, sorry, if the tax regime was 3% or something, you're not going to be ahead at all. Actually, you're going to be choked by the complexity. So,
well, if they weren't inefficient, then everybody would have money offshore,
too. Yeah, that's right. That's right. Yeah.
That is a joke. It's probably true.
No, that's true.
let me just add the...
So there's a battle between all these things going on, with different people, economic, different... See, I don't see a difference between government and big corporations and small corporations. Actually, this is all one continuum. These are all systems that are trying to get as much power as possible. So that's what they are. A general is trying to get as much power for his section of the army. So they advertise, they produce something that they claim is a product, people buy it, people don't buy it. They complexify in order to hide the flaws in their product, and they spin and etc. So I don't see a big difference between government and non-government actors in that way. There is one difference about deployment of coercive force, but even there we see that well-connected corporations are able to tap into the governmental system and the court system, and are able to effectively deploy coercive force by sending police to do debt requisition or so on, or kick employees out of the office. So there's...
Can I just ask you about that same thing, but sort of in reverse, which is the ways in which the sources of information as individuals can and can't be protected? In other words, how their information can be anonymous, like so that they don't pay a price for circulating it. I mean, and, you know, maybe with one example from, you know, from North Korea or Iran, and one example from the U.S., and the differences between those two scenarios.
Well, there's many ways for people to transmit things anonymously. One of the greatest difficulties for sources is their proximity to the material. So if they have high proximity to it and it's a limited number of people know it, it is actually, doesn't matter what technical mechanism you then apply on top, it would be quite difficult for them to evade scrutiny, and it doesn't matter what country or regime you're in. But systematic injustice by definition is going to have to involve many people. And so while the inner sanctum of cabinet, maybe you can't safely get records out of this, but as those decisions start spreading down to lower levels, if they are to affect many people must actually have either the high level planning that produces some unjust consequence, or the shadow of it. So maybe the whole plan isn't visible by the time it gets down to the grunts, but some component of it is visible. And this struck me when we got hold of the two main manuals for Guantanamo Bay. So the 2003 manual was the first one we got hold of, written by Major, by General Jeffrey Miller, who subsequently went over to Abu Ghraib to Gitmoise it, as Donald Rumsfeld called it. So that manual had all sorts of abuses in it. And one of the ones that I was surprised to see was explicit instructions to falsify records for the Red Cross. So, and how many people had read this manual? This was, you know, all the prison captains at Guantanamo Bay had read this, and why would you risk telling the grunts this sort of information? It was only, wasn't even classified. They had made it unclassified for official use only. Why? Because it's more expensive to get people who have classifications in. So when you want to hire all these contractors without classifications, it's cheaper. You can't whisper to the coalface. You can't have the president whispering to the coalface, because the coalface is too big. You can't have the president whispering to the intermediaries, because then you end up with Chinese whispers. And it means your instructions aren't carried out. So if you take information off paper, if you take it outside an electronic or physical paper trail, instructions decay. And that's why all organizations of any scale have rigorous paper trails for the instructions from the leadership. But by definition, if you try and get a lot of people to do something, you're going to have those form of instructions, which means there is always going to be a paper trail, except for small group decisions. But small group decisions that don't end up going to the coalface and instructing hundreds of people, are they so important in the scheme of things?
Well, it was funny that we went to Berlin as the place where they signed the final order.
What's it called?
And these are Germans, so they documented everything.
Yeah.
So it's exactly your point, right? That in order to kill 6 million Jews, you have to actually write it down.
It's a big logistical process.
Absolutely, and many, many people did what the procedures were and so forth and so on. And you know, here are the pictures of people, the signatures, and so forth.
Minutes of the meeting.
I mean, it was like seriously chilling.
Well, this is
the finality of evil.
Yeah. But this is one of the first things in a sort of internal arguments I had with other people in 2006. Well, okay, you have a good get. You expose some organization and show it's been abusing something in some way, and it just takes everything off paper for the next thing it does. Can't they just take everything will go to oral forms and so on? No, it's not going to happen, because if it does go that way, fine. If they take everything off paper, if they internally balkanize, so information can't be leaked. What is the cost? There's a tremendous cost to the organizational efficiency of doing that. And that means this abusive organization simply becomes less powerful in its struggle for economic equilibrium and political equilibrium with all other organizations.
This is the inverse of your argument about empowering the dissidents in Egypt. They need a mechanism to communicate. Your argument, by stopping the inability to coordinate at this level,
that's right.
The inverse of my argument.
Yeah.
Literally the inverse of the first one.
Yeah. So,
your argument would be you have to take those tools away.
Yeah. I say they take them away themselves in a way. Once things can become public, so why is it that people engage? Why is it that powerful organizations? There's all sorts of reasons why non-powerful organizations engage in secrecy, which in my view is legitimate. They need it because they're powerless. But why do powerful organizations engage in secrecy? Well, usually because the plans that they have, if made public, will be proposed by the public, and plans that are opposed before implementation often don't get implemented. So you want to wait as long as possible, and then implementation eventually makes them public. By the very fact that they're being implemented, but it's too late by then to alter the course so effectively. So if we get out. So an organization, on the other hand, that is engaged in planning behavior that, if revealed, is not opposed by the public, it doesn't have that burden. It doesn't have that planning burden where it is forced to take things off paper. So this will be an efficient organization, and this will not be an efficient organization. And in the mix, as they do economic and political battle, it will equilibrate out. These guys will shrink and these guys will grow.
Is that your fundamental justification, do you think, for what you're doing?
Fundamental justification is that there's really two. First of all, that human civilization, in its good part, is based upon our full intellectual record, and our intellectual record should be as large as possible if humanity is to be as advanced as possible. The second is that in practice, releasing information is positive to those engaged in acts that the public supports and negative to those engaged in acts that the public does not support.
So it has a self-restraint.
Yeah. Well, it can create a redress for an act of injustice that is revealed, and that's nice. But the larger effect is that it creates disincentives for organisations that are to create unjust plans or engage in unjust acts.
One more follow-up. In 10 years, what does this world look like? In other words, if you extrapolate this argument.
Well, we're at a bit of a crossroads, you know. It can go either way.
Okay. To an optimistic scenario and a pessimistic scenario.
So remember Philip Zimmerman's PGP case?
Yes.
So that was just a grand jury investigation. It was moderately serious, but actually he wasn't convicted. No one at that time was being convicted, they were investigated. It changed the behavior of tens of thousands of people who were involved in choosing to put cryptography into programs or not. All sorts of tortured copyright assignments and inter-software company structuring arrangements and how code was deployed were engaged in just from that negative signal of the grand jury investigation. So what that means is that signals about what behavior is acceptable, what behavior you can get away with, and what behavior is beneficial to individuals engaging in it, and what behavior is not, changes how many people behave. So we are at a crossroads now where those organizations that are fighting against those people who want to be able to publish freely and disclose important information to the public. I can't remember the beginning of the sentence now.
You said that there are crossroads now where those organizations fighting against those people who want to be able to publish freely and disclose information.
Pretty long, wasn't it? Okay. could produce, if successful, a signal which discourages everyone almost everyone from engaging in those activities. Or we and people who share our values could be successful, and that will then become the new norm of accepted behavior.
And what are the necessary conditions for that to occur with the latter? I can easily imagine the necessary conditions for the former.
Everyone gives money to Wikileaks.
I didn't even hear you. Yes, everyone gives money to Wikileaks.
Are you taking Bitcoin?
Yes. So it's quite interesting to know whether if people read this and then act, will their action be enough to change the result? So that is why we had a very interesting period that I think actually we're literally at this crossroads, and a little bit more push to one direction or another could change the outcome a lot. So people should, if they want to see the values that we promote succeed, promote those organizations and individuals that represent those values and start taking on doing it themselves.
I was going to say, or become.
Yeah, become representations of those values themselves. I'm always hesitant in saying everyone should go out and be a martyr, because I don't believe that. I believe the most effective activists are those that fight and run away, actually, not those who fight and martyr themselves, but those who fight and run away and fight another day. So that's about judgment, when to engage in the fight and when to withdraw. So to preserve your resources for the next fight.
Would you make the argument that fighting and running away is not that, like physically fighting and running away is not that different from fighting anonymously, so long as you're sufficiently confident that your anonymity...
If you have perfect anonymity, you can fight forever and don't have to run away.
That's, you pre-run away.
Yeah, that's pre-run away.
Well, you can lower the courage threshold. I mean, that's one of the nice things that anonymity does. But maybe it's not the right way to put it. I mean, people often say, well, you were tremendously courageous in what you're doing, etc., etc. And I say, no, you misunderstand what courage is. Courage is not the absence of fear. Only fools have no fear. Rather, courage is the intellectual mastery of fear by understanding the true risks of the situation and opportunities. And then keeping these things in balance. And not simply having prejudice about what the risks are, but actually testing them. Because there's lots of sort of myths that go around about what can be done and what cannot be done. Actually, it's important to test. And you don't test by jumping off a bridge, you test by jumping off a footstool and then jumping off something a bit higher and a bit higher.
Can I say a follow-up to that? And it goes back to what Scott was asking about the relationship between the person providing the information and the person receiving it. If we look at all the different societies around the world, presumably not everybody's starting on the same level playing field. There's some people that have a just greater education of the risks associated with using these tools. There's some people who are going to provide information in societies where the governments aren't as vigilant. There's some where they're very vigilant. And it would seem that a place... Yeah, like in Iran or in North Korea, where the combination of very vigilant regimes with populations that are still relatively new to these tools and the risks associated with them may not be able to actually have that understanding of the true risks of the situation and opportunities that you're mentioning.
I think they're capable of learning like everyone else. These societies are much more political than the West. People like to talk about politics over dinner every night. So I'm not sure it's right to take this Western eye and think that these people don't understand the lot that they're in. Also, the extrinsic risks might be higher. The other risks associated with conducting a political life may already be quite high. So one has to keep these risks in proportion. Also, the risks, the potential rewards are much greater. One might be involved in some very grand historic moment and then become swept up in it. And because we all only live once, we all suffer the continuous risk of not having lived our life well every year. Every year that is not used is 100% wasted. It's not a risk of that, it's a dead bet.
It's a side for you. So I was with Warren Buffett, and it was 78. And I said, what are you up to? And he said, this next year will be the best year of my life.
It's okay. I need to go to the restroom.
Just go upstairs. And so I said, okay. He's obviously playing with me. So we figured it out. That if you're 76, the next year is going to be the best year of the rest of your life. Because at some point, there's going to be a year where it's not going to be so good, and then you're going to be dead. And so I love that, right? This next year is going to be the best year.
Julie, how do you feel about photographs for the book? Do you mind if I take snapshots of you guys just working? How do you... You can see them. But they're up to you. I would just take like shots this way and maybe shots that way.
Who doing what to exactly?
You guys talking, just conversation.
That's all right.
Yeah.
Using my S95 camera.
Yes, exactly. It's a very high tech operation.
Just don't say anything anti-Semitic in the next few months.
Anti-Semitic. We would never say anything anti-Semitic.
No, just the last. This Russian journalist came over and took a photo with me, and then his name's Israel Shamir, actually. So he's as Jewish as can possibly be, but he converted to Russian Orthodox and is very, very anti-Judaism. And so he then put this thing out in Russian Reporter or something with his photo with me, and then I started to cop it. Like in the most unbelievable way.
You and I both understand the costs of negative publicity.
This is just a joke, but I know you have been well tested.
I am very well tested. Very well.
Where
are you going? That's supposed to be safe.
I know.
Try to look proper. Get your hat.
Now you messed up my picture.
Oh, sorry. Okay. Anyway, the criticism that is constant is that damage has occurred because of WikiLeaks. I can't find it yet. Do you have a reason?
Well, it's a rhetorical trick.
Okay.
So
you understand why I'm asking.
The yeah. There's a
trying to understand the case against your vision.
Yeah. There's
obviously we're sympathetic to. So
up until collateral murder, we were a cause célèbre in the United States. Actually, we're still a cause célèbre, but it's in a smaller libertarian or left wing.
Yeah.
Yes.
Or libertarian right wing community now. But, and across, according to Reuters, across 24 countries, we have a three-quarter support of the general population of 24 countries. It's the worst in the United States. So we have support over 40% of the population, which is pretty good, actually, considering what's been happening. So as a result of embarrassing the US military and the diplomatic class, we have had a counterattack. And that counterattack is significant. This is a very significant power group. And it's a power group that is not just at the top of the White House, it's not just a few generals. Rather, it is all the people connected to and profiting from that system. And that's about a third of the US population. So all the way from Chelsea Clinton down to someone in the gutters of San Antonio whose brother is deployed in Iraq. There are 900,000 people in the United States with top secret security clearances at this moment. There are 2.5 million that have classified security clearances. If we go back over the past 20 years and ask how many people had security clearances, maybe it's 15 million. If you then go and look at all their spouses and business partners and children, we're looking at something like 30% of the population of the United States is 1 degree removed from that way of living and that ideological structure and that patronage system. So it's quite difficult in the United States to say something that is against that system. And the New York Times has found to its peril when it tries to speak out against it. And so in its relationships with us, when you publish material, had to react very defensively in a way to someone outside, you know. I think even traditional US journalists think this. It is sickening to see a newspaper of any strength saying literally how pleased those words the White House was with its behavior. So if we look at the attacks on us, they always talk about the words placed people at risk. But risk relative to what? Right now, we are at risk of a meteorite passing through the roof of this house and killing us all. That is a risk, it is true. But is it a proportionate risk? Is it a risk that is significant enough that is even worth speaking about? Well, the answer is no. Similarly with the word possibility. There's a possibility a meteorite could descend on us all in this moment. But it is not a probability. So these rhetorical tricks are often used by people who are making their argument in relation to security, that there is a risk of something, there is a possibility of something. What has to be done is people need to engage in a sort of intellectual defense against manipulation by rhetoric, by understanding that if someone mentions that there's a risk without saying the risk is higher than crossing the road, or the risk is twice that of being stung by a bee, then you must ignore it. Similarly with possibility versus probability.
Yeah, I can do all of this in my head too. Are there examples where a positive outcome that can be directly traced to WikiLeaks in the political sphere that you want to highlight? Something, a specific tangible positive outcome.
Well, the most significant one seems to be the Arab Spring.
And you would argue
that it was a clear... Well, Amnesty International did in its latest report, and Tunisian professors did. Because of my direct involvement, it would be unseemly for me to argue that directly. I'm not certain about directly. I am certain that we affected it and were deeply involved in it. I'm certain that we influenced it. And that is really something of great moment. Something I am certain about is that we changed the outcome of the Kenyan election in 2007. There's been many ministers whose scalps we've taken and people being forced to resign and so on. Those are concrete and clear actions. And one might argue that they're positive if you didn't like the guy, and you would argue that they're negative if you did like the guy, so I don't really want to mention those.
So if I go back to your earlier argument, that the effect on a single individual is not the actual goal. The actual effect is to change the system in some fundamental way, because you make the argument that these systems have become fiscalized. You know, they're static, independent of any pressure. And so an example of a truly large influence would be a revolution.
It's something that is... You can make many large influences without these sort of dichotomatic events. But the dichotomatic events are easy to... binary events are easy to talk about, and it's sort of provable.
But it's also a marketing problem. You want to have a marketing story.
Yeah. So one party or another party wins the election, and it changed. And that's a very clear sort of outcome. There's a revolution. One group was in power, then another group's in power. It's a very clear... very clear change. I suspect the other changes that we have had, such as liberalization of the publishing environment, I suspect is actually the most significant one that we've been involved in, and something we've pushed for many years. There's no way that what we did last year we could have done 4 years ago. It would not have been possible.
How come, technologically, or in terms of...
Technologically, it was all perfectly possible. The difference is... a shift in status quo. WikiLeaks became the status quo. So... And that wasn't always so. During the first 2 years, we were battling for whether we were something that was acceptable to be on the internet or not. After 2 years, and especially after the Bank Julius Baer case, where we were involved in a big legal case in San Francisco. On the one hand, us. On the other hand, the largest private Swiss banking concern, Bank Julius Baer, that was trying to shut us down, which we conclusively won. And cost them their US IPO as a result. That sort of sent out a signal that there is a place in the world for a publisher like WikiLeaks. And then we started to cement that place as time went by. And now we have really cemented it, because we had a case where the Pentagon stood up in public and gave a 40, many times actually, but back in October, gave a 40-minute press conference with their spokesperson, Jeff Morrell, saying that WikiLeaks must, and me personally, must destroy everything we had previously published. Been derived from the Pentagon, destroy everything we're going to publish, and cease dealing with US military whistleblowers. The precise phraseology used was return everything that we had ever published, return everything we were going to publish, and cease soliciting information from US military personnel or US government personnel. Or the Pentagon would compel us to do so. And when asked by a journalist at the press conference, what mechanisms do you have to compel them? The response was, well, look, this is the Pentagon. We're not concerned about the law. That's perhaps a matter for the Department of Justice or the Attorney General.
When you watched that, did you get the impression that there was just an unbelievable level of naivete or lack of understanding about the actual technology and technical aspects of this that would make that impossible?
I did, but then I later on developed a more sophisticated understanding of what was going on in that press conference.
I actually started out very unsophisticated.
So what was actually going on is this was a carefully... I mean, it seems ridiculous. Why would the Pentagon act like a victim? Why would they look so ridiculous and powerless? Why would they give a demand that they were not capable of fulfilling? It would make them look weak. It was a carefully constructed legal message designed to embroil us in the U.S. Espionage Act. It was a notification, like you see in the newspapers. We demand that you do this. This is the type of information. It will cause grave harm to U.S. national security. We make it a press conference so we can argue that all those WikiLeaks people have seen it. Then the next thing they publish, they will demonstrate intent. So despite the fact that they have been informed that it is this, 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 and this, they did it anyway, therefore they have an intent, because you can't accidentally commit espionage.
That's why they're concerned with the past and not just with the present. Because there has to be a pattern of practice, and as long as it's each instance is a fresh instance, yeah, then there is no pattern.
Yeah. But in saying no, which we did quickly, actually before we understood what the legal trap was, but in saying no, and then in relatively short order producing the Iraq war diaries, and it's one of the best things we've ever done. What about the... Okay.
I wasn't going to steal it, but I'm just going to bring it.
Moving into other room.
I don't know, censorship argument for that thing.
Right. Increasingly using WikiLeaks information as a source, and done, you know, sometimes done without even mentioning that it was a source. Sometimes, you know, it's a sociology of information, which is fascinating.
In the beginning, they wouldn't. Now they do. It gives them more prestige now to say that it came from us than to.
I know.
Funny, isn't it?
I know. It is.
You did also work for one reporter.
I'll just show you something funny.
Yeah, please, this is spectacular.
I'll just show you something. Do you like our slogan? Keep calm
and carry on.
Yeah, it's Second World War. That looks like an original one, though.
No, we were admiring pictures of all of the owners' ancestors.
So these are Vaughan's ancestors. Oh, that's Vaughan there, my friend.
So yeah, this is Vaughan. Okay.
That's from Afghanistan earlier this year.
He's a sort of a reporter type, right?
He's a war reporter.
I'm sorry. Who is this?
This is the owner of the house, my friend Vaughan Smith.
Oh, right. I've been to his club.
Yeah, so he's a war reporter. And although he was in the Grenadier Guards originally, and then he went to the other side, but also you could go to more wars as a war reporter than you could.
And different ones. It's better that way. And these are all family? This is his family?
These are all family. That's father and mother, and they both live here. On the house on the edge.
So it's a military family from a little way.
The other interesting guy is that guy there, Tiger Smith, the sort of rackish looking one with the collar up, who's famous for killing 99 tigers back when that sort of thing was approved of.
So he was
saving Indians.
He was a Raj figure of some kind.
Yeah. And, so here's the comedy part. So this medal. Vaughan's father was the Queen's messenger.
Wow.
So that means he would go on aeroplanes and deliver messages. Now, see this bag in his hand there? Mm. So you know what's in this bag?
State secrets.
Diplomatic cables.
That's great.
So he would go on this...
That's great.
On the Concorde and have a seat to the left and a seat to the right just filled with... Cable
really?
Bags and deliver it. Sometimes they'd take computers as well, and you have people come to the bay of the aeroplane and guide it in, make sure it's not stolen, and other guys waiting at the other end to take it.
Then what does he say about it?
Well, he's sort of horrified on the one hand, mm-hmm, and deeply pleased on the other, because if they just used him, none of this would have happened.
and before you ask him, and he's saying that he's actually, you've been here for about 6 months.
8 months.
8 months, yeah. So this is your home.
What's a lovely place?
I got these this morning from, because I have to go to the police station every day. Unfortunately, I get crazed fans turning up there.
Oh, really?
Mm.
And they hand you things?
So this was a French girl who drove up from France.
Really?
How far is the...
I pay girls drive French. From France, Catalonia, Norway. Didn't drive from Norway. Flew from Norway. Amsterdam. We had a guy from the US sold his boat and came over here. Captain Morgan.
How far is the is this police station?
It's about
15 minutes. 20 minutes. Wow. It's pretty funny. The woman from Catalonia was the most amusing. So she turned up at the Frontline Club and tried to convince them that she was WikiLeaks star Spanish programmer. And of course, they're not knowing anything about programming, you know, it's like she just gave some techno babble and like they assumed it was true. And then after a while, they're like, yeah, well, you can't really see Julian, you know, he's in seclusion, but okay. So I put her up for free for one night, and she had this habit of sort of listening in on a bit of conversation and then sort of reincorporating it into a story. And like saying, oh, I know this person. Oh, look, there's so-and-so. But within 2 days, this had all come undone, and she'd been sent along. And then 2 weeks later, there's a phone call saying, oh, so 2 weeks later, I'm here, and the police come to the door, and they're saying, do you know Ruth? Ruth who? Your fiance. No. Well, she stayed at this property all night. And she says that you were going to pay the taxi bill. And I'm like, what taxi bill? So it turns out that she had come from Catalonia to London, got a black cab from London to here, £500. She had £50. Convinced the taxi driver that her rich, famous fiancé would pay for it. They were just in a bit of a dispute at the moment, but it was sorted out in the morning. Then she had gone to the edge of the property and convinced them that she was my fiancé. And the taxi driver wouldn't go because he wanted his money. The people at the edge of the property put them both up for the night.
At what point do you just pay her for the creative
It's for the entertainment.
I mean, it's just so creative. It's almost impressive. It's
Then she was eventually arrested for fare evasion. Because we know no one's going to pay the bill.
Oh, it's
bailed to appear on February 14, Valentine's Day.
At which point?
With bail conditions that she couldn't appear in Norfolk, so she flew back to Catalonia. But then we see that on her Facebook page, she's still going on about how in love she is, and that and these terrible women that lived here prevented her from coming in contact with
her. Oh my goodness.
Proving that everything on the internet is absolutely true. Mm-hmm. Every single fact.
Especially Facebook.
Especially Facebook. Everything is true. Wow.
Interesting. Did you have a question?
No, I'm good. I'm good, actually.
I want to be sensitive to your energy and time. I think it would be interesting to talk a little bit about...
Where you should go for a walk then.
It'll be interesting to talk about the various sort of what if scenarios, right? Because that's what we're very interested in. This is Jared and I do this all the time. Mm. You know, what are some scenarios that could play out? You know, try to actually think about it. You know, you have all these different actors and players. You obviously think about it. You're basically a physicist, right? You think about it that way.
In thinking about what if scenarios, I think there's actually it can actually be useful to think what if in the past. Like while we were sitting there, you know, one of our chapters looks at intervention in the context of a futuristic genocide. But I think it's actually a more useful conversation in terms of understanding the role that WikiLeaks could play in a situation like that to ask, you know, in 1994, had the technological state of the world today been the technological state then, and WikiLeaks was around during the Rwanda genocide, what might have changed? How might things have been different?
It's
wondering if the weather will change.
Yeah, I think the weather. Welcome to British weather.
The cloud will move.
The Rwandan genocide. Yes, I think it would have been. I think it would have been a bit different if they had internet and a number of phones in Rwanda. I think the message would have come out more, although maybe not that much. I mean, in the Congo, all the bad things happening in the Congo aren't really getting much traction in the West.
That's a fantastic tree. It keeps totally dry.
That's good.
And I guess, that's sort of, there's a larger what if question here, which is, it's part what if and part why. Why haven't there been people in places like Iran or North Korea or Congo, releasing documents in the same ways as there have been, say, in Western democracies?
Well, we have actually. We did have gotten a bit of material from Iran, actually. I think it's not that easy to do a WikiLeaks. In a combination of technicalities and reputation and funding and so on, it's not that easy to do. And we don't. That's keeping reputation.
Right. I just wanted to make sure that was what you were thinking.
But let's ask the question bluntly. So why are you not getting enormous numbers of anonymous USB drives about the bad documents in African countries that are run by these evil dictator types? Don't you think that everyone would be incentivized to use you? Shouldn't they?
We have gotten some decent African stuff, decent East Timorese stuff, lots of decent Latin American stuff.
Is it because these governments don't write down as much of the stuff?
They're not as networked.
Okay.
Some of them, like a Tanzanian government, use Kiswahili. They don't use English as their governmental language. A lot of it is to do just whether they perceive that WikiLeaks is a political actor within their country. So for East Timor, once we started doing a little bit of East Timor, we got a lot more East Timor, and then the sort of flood opened up. And it just became routine. To give us material, but they need to perceive that we are part of the community. For Russia, I think the small amount of material that we've released about Russia, although now we have this RU leaks that has been doing pretty well, but historically the small amount of material that we've been releasing for Russia is actually a positive sign, in that the Russian internet sphere is actually very vibrant.
And so it's just there, it's amazing.
Yeah, so it feels that, it doesn't look outside so much. Why would it look at an English language website like WikiLeaks? Mm. I mean, it has its sort of non-profit activists, journalists and opposition and so on, all in that internet sphere, which is relatively free compared to Russian TV. So they don't see that they really need this other avenue.
Mm-hmm. It just seems like
there was a publication of a whole bunch of FSB documents on an American server, which was then immediately hacked and they were taken down and never seen again. It's not so easy to do. It's not so easy to publish against powerful state actors, actually.
Mm-hmm. No. I mean, you've talked a lot about the importance of the name. That's been sort of an important theme in this conversation. And so it makes me wonder, how much the kind of, there's the debut in which, the site goes live. Then there's really the major debut where it becomes, a household term or a household name. And one of the things that we're playing around with in the book is
we haven't properly used that yet, though. I mean, we haven't been able to grow as fast as the name has been able to grow.
But even so, people know what WikiLeaks is, and I wonder, had the first batch of documents that you received been from, say, an Iran or from a North Korea, and released, if the world would have looked at it as a whistleblowing platform.
It did. The world did up until we started producing a high volume of U.S. military stuff. Yeah. We were producing thousands of pages of U.S. military stuff back in 2007.
And nobody noticed.
That's interesting.
Because of collateral damage videos.
Well, nobody... People noticed the Guantanamo stuff, but not to the household name. We were a journalistic name pretty quickly, actually. And in the techno part of the human rights community, we were named pretty quickly. And we were in the internet educated German and English speaking publics, especially towards the crypto security end, we were named pretty quickly. So for example, when we did a fundraising effort at the beginning of 2010 to May 2010, before Claddagh murder, we raised $1 million. So, you know, for a new sort of, new in terms of concept, non-profit journalism group to raise $1 million in $20 donations, that's almost completely unheard of. And we were doing that before Claddagh murder. So Claddagh murder made us into a worldwide household. No, not even Claddagh murder did, actually. Made us into a US household name. All these things started to stack up by the end of the year, and really it was the Pentagon's attack against us and the Swedish sex case, funnily enough, that then made us into a worldwide household name with 84% name recognition worldwide.
Mm-hmm. That's interesting. So on the assumption that the current legal stuff is all resolved, the next few years are WikiLeaks. What happens with WikiLeaks? It becomes, I mean, again, we want to talk about, I mean, for us, T equals zero is a year from now, right? So thinking a year from now, like the next year, does WikiLeaks just become bigger, more donors, more technology? You can change it in some way?
But there's lots of changes. I think this idea I have about how to structure intellectual information is important. And we will overlay that. So
that's actually part of your plan, yeah, that you're talking about. Okay.
When you do have a presence, when you have such public recognition, you have the luxury of being able to take fairly complex intellectual ideas and push them up. Mm-hmm. Like, that would normally take a long time to sort of organically get traction, like some with Sundeep with Java as an example. So it'd take a long time to organically get traction, but you can put your weight behind them, push them up. So we have some of those moves we can make. But also I've seen that it's very difficult for us to be a command and control organization. And you spoke about the difficulties that you had to learn with Nobel. But for us as an organization, like a command and control organization with a leadership and people who carry out tasks, we're in a position where we have the full force of the superpower and its investigative organs and the rest of NATO operating against us, bribing people, monitoring communications, etc. So that means that for us, any little psychological weakness in our people, any friction between our people, can lead to those forces plucking them off.
Yeah. Or you could be infiltrated even.
Yeah.
I mean, in theory.
Or infiltrated. The plucking off, I think, is a bigger problem. But,
But the forces opposed to
you. You're right, the infiltration.
Yeah, but the forces opposed to you, they will think, okay, this is a foreign actor, let's send our agent in, you know, become a member, discover all their secrets. That's
right,
the
right.
Thing,
so, right. So, I mean, we are aware of that problem, and so we investigate people and all this stuff. So, but what that means is it has tremendously slowed down our growth, because you can't just put an ad out and say, we want you to have these skills and come into the office. It is absolutely impossible. So growth is constrained in that way. But there's another way of leading, and that's leading through values instead of command and control. And when you lead through values, you don't need to trust people. Mm-hmm. And values, and the number of people who can adopt a value, there's no limit on the speed of adoption. It all happened very, very quickly. As it's not supply, in terms of employer supply, limited, rather it's demand limited. As soon as people demand the value, they can adopt it.
I say that, the way I express that is that the power of an idea is underappreciated.
point. If you can get the idea inserted correctly, then millions of people. Right. So, so my comment would be that the deeper ideas that you're talking about are being, they're either not understood or they're being fought by misinformation. Right? You know, as you said, you know, it's a clever use of words to turn against you or what have you. You know, you have, I think, a challenge to get the deeper arguments that you've made to us heard over all these other forces.
I mean, people, if saying it, well, actually, you say lies long enough, people start to believe them as well. But, so this, the Afghan release was a terrible thing. This has now sort of spread so fast that we're basically given up trying to knock it down. The energy's better off spent doing something else. But we do see that we are educating a whole range of people about us and about our values and about things that we believe in. And now what is happening is that these people are finding each other across the world and across states. And so we are creating our own computational network of human beings that we can think in the same way, that sort of on a point-to-point basis can trust each other. And so we started out last year in a position where we had this big confrontation with the State Department and the Pentagon at the same time, where one of our few claims to success is that we've managed to get the Pentagon and the State Department to cooperate. where they as internally were highly organized. They have their contact sheets, they have an internal mail system, and they have a command and control structure where they can task people and recruit resources for things. And they have people available to spend on us. Maybe there's 10,000. So that's, in that particular case, the people that are pushing against us. On the other hand, on our side, we have millions of people around the world who support us and support our values, who are, on the other hand, traditionally completely atomized. There's no command and control structure. They're not able to effectively coordinate with each other. And so on. So that's the starting condition. But of course, an organization starts to form with these people as they find each other locally and as they discover each other. And they become optimized, that network of nodes starts linking up and becoming more and more efficient at comprehending its environment, planning for action, and then acting. So there's some ways that, some plans we have to potentiate that. So they're probably out by then. So we're going to take these graphs of several million supporters, and do you know what simulated annealing is? So when you have an alloy, rather, when you're trying to make an alloy of two different metals, and the idea is you put these metals together and you mix them together, and they settle, the molecules of the two different respective metals settle into an arrangement with each other where they are in the sort of tightest attraction to each other, the lowest energy state. And to get them into this state can be quite hard, because if one molecule might be buddied up with another to its left, but the strongest arrangement might be if it joins the molecules to its right. It's already close to the ones to its left, so it has to sort of, it needs a kick to get out of the position it's in and into this new position. And so this is called annealing, and you'll see that when people are making these alloys, they will melt the metals together, pour them, and then let them cool a bit, and then heat them up a bit, let them cool a bit, heat them up a bit, not so much each time. And they might even do things like smack them and hit them. So they might actually physically smash them. So we have this system we are developing where we will put all these people into a network which we will anneal using a simulated annealing method, so that there is the tightest possible human arrangement between these million people.
Around the set of principles.
Around the set of principles. That's the unifier.
I see.
And then we have an efficient computational, in terms of human computation, efficient computational network, which can observe, plan, and act.
So, another criticism, I think, is with respect to WikiLeaks, you were careful, according to reports, to work to redact sensitive information. As I understand it, there was an editing process. Somebody had to build a specialized search engine because the documents were so complicated. There was a fairly lengthy review period with the mainstream media, you know, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And that's all, I think, fairly well documented. Now, imagine another person, not you, who does not have the same values, but has the same technology, because the technology is obviously copyable. What happens when there's more of them than there are of you? Or one of them,
well,
or one of you?
Sources. So who holds WikiLeaks accountable? We have our values. How do people see whether we're sticking to our values or we've betrayed our values? How do people, maybe they don't like our values. Or maybe they do like our values. How can this human economic ecosystem discipline us or encourage us in particular directions? So sources speak with their feet. If sources believe that we are going to protect them and that we're going to have high impact for the material, they will simply give us material instead of giving it to someone else. So that's one way in which we are disciplined by the market of sources.
So it's a selection bias, basically.
Yeah. So the question is, well, could sources pick another group that were going to publish without any harm minimization procedure at all? Well, the answer is yes. But one has to understand the primary reason we engage in harm minimization procedures. It's not actually because material we will release will have a reasonable risk of producing harm as a result of disclosure. That's very rare. Rather, there is actually a probable risk that if we don't engage in that sort of behavior, our opponents will opportunistically attempt to distract from the revelations that we have revealed very important matters by instead speaking about, is there a potential for harm, and therefore is this release hypocritical, given that we want to promote justice and is the organization hypocritical. So a lot of the procedures that we engage in, it's not merely to try and minimize risk to people who might be named in material. Rather, it is to minimize risk that opportunists will reduce the impact of the material when it's released. So it's part of the impact maximization that we're doing, is to prevent this type of attack on what we publish. So from that point of view, intelligence sources will understand that we do that in order to maximize impact. Now that said, we do not permanently redact anything. We only do delayed redactions. So we delay until the security situation has changed and we can release this. And I think that is an important difference to what...
Is it fair to say, I'm not trying to put words in your mouth, that eventually the things you redacted will be
all
made available?
All be made available.
But that's a different question, actually, I think, from what you were asking, which is, what if the same process and technology...
So I'm getting to that. But it disturbs me greatly. It is a... And we have all sorts of other projects about syndicating our submission system to third parties and so on. But it disturbs me that we are redacting at all. It is a very, very dangerous slippery slope. Now, I've already said that we go through this not merely to minimize harm, but for political considerations, to stop people distracting from the important part of the material by instead hyping up concerns about risks.
It's just a pragmatic decision. It's a pragmatic,
tactical decision to keep the maximum impact there instead of having it being distracted against. So, but that is us already engaging in a rather dangerous compromise. Now, it's not nearly to the same degree as the newspapers, because we've done this collaboration with them. We can see that it's just appalling. I mean, we release these results of the analysis of their redactions versus what actually needed to redact. It's extremely interesting.
So there was a difference. There was a difference of view on what needed to be.
The Guardian redacted 2/3 of a cable about Bulgarian crime, removed all the names of the people who had infiltrated, the mafioso who had infiltrated the Bulgarian government. Removed a description of the Kazakhstan elite, saying the Kazakhstan elite in general were corrupt, not even a particular name, just in general. Removed a description that a energy company out of Italy operating in Kazakhstan was corrupt. So that they have redacted for naming of individual names of people who might be unfairly put at risk, just like we do, as we require of them. They have redacted the names of mafioso, individual mafioso, because they're worried about they might get sued for libel in London by these mafioso. They have redacted the description of a class, Kazakhstan elite. The class has been corrupt, and they have redacted descriptions of individual companies being corrupt, because they don't want to expose themselves to any risk at all. And that's true for the Irish Independent, even though very good newspaper, the journalists totally on side legally, they do this incredible self-censorship across the board, and they don't admit doing it. They don't reveal the fact that they're doing it. So we don't want to go down that path. I'm sure these groups also started out as, no, we will just do these little redactions, and then economics comes into play, and then why take the risk, and so on. And so you end up with a system of self-censorship, and it's embarrassing to do it, so why tell the public that you're doing it, but you're not telling the public you're doing it, so it gets easier and easier to do every time. If we look at email, who censors email? No one censors email. We look at a telephone call to your grandmother. Is there a censor there sitting on the line determining whether you are about to say something bad to your grandmother and cutting it out? Of course not. The postal system. Are there people opening envelopes to see whether you're sending something bad? No. YouTube. A priori. Is anyone sitting there reviewing every video before it's posted? Yeah,
let me give you the technical answer so you make sure you know it. We can't review every submission, so we basically, the crowd marks it if it's a problem, and then
but post-publication. So once it's out, people can take copies, and it could be spreading everywhere.
And what happens is the takedown. We get into trouble because various players want us to do pre-publication review, but with 48 hours of YouTube video coming in every minute, we can't mechanically do it. Right. So there is, if somebody posts something wrong or evil or a violation of law, whatever, there is a gap, hopefully short, between the time it's published and then marked for further review against our policies. And the policies are well specified in the document. Yeah.
It's pretty high bar, though, but to take stuff down. It's not just wrong as in, well, like, factually wrong.
But under the way these things work, commercial websites have it. We can decide what we want to allow, what we don't. Right. We have a set of criteria. You can see them. You can read them. Mm-hmm. So we don't want, we want some kinds of videos and some other kind, and we don't want other kind of videos, and you can't violate copyright and all that kind of stuff.
Well, I rather like what happened to Collateral Murder. So Collateral Murder was instantly got flagged up by our opponents as rated over 18. So no one could see it directly on YouTube without logging in. Mm-hmm. But for an embed, they could see it just fine. And so my interpretation of this is that when there's an embed, someone else's brand is on the damn thing. And when it's not an embed, your brand is on it.
without knowing the specifics, all I can tell you is the system is responsive to the post-publication feedback. There have been a couple cases in YouTube where there have been rating scams where, you know, Jared will publish a document and people will decide they want to demote him. So they'll give him a lot of negatives because he's being attacked, and then he becomes unfairly lower ranked than he really should be. So these systems are manipulable by pressure groups, and I would think that would be a constant.
Sometimes by regimes. I mean, there's some autocratic regimes that will flag content posted by activists as inappropriate.
Yeah, we've had stuff that we've posted by anti-Scientologists who've done. I think there were 5,000 Scientology videos were removed from YouTube when some lawyer claimed that they're all swore that they're all his copyright, etc. So we suffer because we do purely really political, I don't mean party political, I mean to do with this political sphere and how power is delegated, that's when we are political. Because we do deal with almost purely political material, there is such scrutiny on us that if we, at least at this moment, if we were to go to a publish first, pull later, they would go, oh, well, it's too late. You put it all out there. Now there's a thousand copies.
Again, you have a different model, right? You require human editors.
Well, it's a problem, though. It is a severe problem because it means, in terms of scalability, things are very hard for us. And so that's why we have this new syndication system where we're syndicating the editing to various
non-profits. But you're fundamentally outsourcing the human judgment because it's not possible today to write computer algorithms that would do this thing.
Well, I think that this human judgment actually is more... Yes, there is some cost to publishing without vetting, but actually the problems of vetting before publication are so severe that they are much, much greater problems. And if you had the choice, you have to choose between these two, you would choose publication without vetting.
So that's also interesting to I think us. That says you would fundamentally prefer. You're so concerned about this human judgment and
compromised, and other people will also try and once they understand that we have a lever to determine what is published and not published, people will try and get that lever by levering us.
I want to make sure we've got Jared. Other questions, Lisa?
I had a follow-up question on that. I mean, again, we're looking futuristically in each aspect of the book, and what I wonder is, you know, you have a certain volume of content that you're getting right now, but at a certain point, and at one point, you know, Twitter only had so much content as well. At a certain point, it does become so overwhelming that to your point, if there's no, if you publish everything that gets sent, at what point is there such a mixture? Is there so much content that is just manipulated that it essentially drowns out the legitimate.
The manipulated content will never be the issue. Although there is something to be said for having a perfect record, which we do at the moment. But manipulated content will always be an insignificant quantity of material. And the reason is it takes economic work to manipulate content. To do it well, you need someone who's even more intelligent than the person who would have created the original document, even more informed. And if the whole document is going public, this is not like a news story where you give the journalist manipulated content. You have to fool all the opponents and everyone else in the world with the material. It's a lot harder. So, and at the same time, every organization generates a mountain of paperwork and internal records just by virtue of its activity. So those, all those records are produced for free. So the legitimate content will always outweigh the manipulated content. The problem is that
a
small bit of manipulated content can devalue the large amount of unmanipulated content.
Can I disagree with you on one point? I fundamentally believe that disinformation becomes so easy to generate, and because complexity overwhelms knowledge, that it's in the people's interest, if you will, over the next decade to build disinformation generating systems. That it should be true for corporations, for marketing, for governments,
yep.
and so forth. And it just makes the job for a legitimate journalist that much harder, right? Because there's just, and you know, your answer earlier was that this is fundamentally a trust problem, which I think is roughly correct. I would argue that it's fundamentally a ranking problem, but ranking is based on trust and other algorithms. It's the same conclusion. But I think it's not, in my view, correct to say that there will always be more sort of tactically correct information than a small amount of manipulated. Perfectly reasonable that the actors will see that computer, you know, AI systems can generate a lot of false stuff. You're well aware of, you know, the projects to write papers by computer.
Yeah, I've seen that.
I mean,
everyone always thought that we'd get flooded with those. It never happened.
You've not.
But do you think you...
Never happened. We have had, literally, if you exclude the nutters mm-hmm. going on about how over a garden party one night 12 years ago, speaking to his ex-wife with a pot plant in between them, she told him that he was the Antichrist and he understood it was true. If you exclude those cases, which we get a fair bit of, the genuine attempted frauds, there have been about 20. Okay. It's extraordinary. It's almost nothing.
No, but let's argue. You could make an argument that that's a statement about altruism and good, and that the steps required to actually manipulate are hard enough that you have to be pretty badly intended.
Yeah.
You have to, the threshold for doing that's pretty high, right? In other words...
So what's the closest? It's the pump and dump scams and stocks, I guess that's the one that we see fairly frequently. And where they've pushed things, they've done it as gifts, and they even have things to evade OCR recognition on emails.
I mean, in Google's case, we see lots and lots of link farms, which are attempting to manipulate our rankings.
I know that what we're seeing now, we're seeing HB Gary, this intelligence contractor, high-tech intelligence contractor, was hired by, was asked by Bank of America to submit a tender, and we got hold of their copy of the tender. We don't know who ended up taking the tender to take us down. The quote was $2 million a month, and they would spread disinformation, and they would hack this, and they would target our journalists, and they had network maps of people who supported us, and they would leverage their careers and self-interests versus their ideology, etc. So that's there, but I mean, disinformation has always been there. I'm not sure why it should increase relative to the information increase we're seeing everywhere else.
But this, by the way, is a fundamental argument against something you and I talked about earlier. We do actually need to resolve this. Does the rate of disinformation
arm wrestling maybe?
But I think there's more. This is actually one of the most interesting. I mean, the whole conversation's been fascinating. But this last piece is really interesting because it plays into how Eric and I are thinking about, and Scott are thinking about these chapters. It's like, imagine 10 years from now, or imagine 15 years. So, you know, for the purposes of, you know, argument, let's imagine 10 years from now. It's very easy, not just for a large group of people, to sort of create fake documents, produce them in mass, and distribute them in mass. Let's assume a single individual has that capacity through, you know, the technological platforms they have.
But you won't have Julian Assange saying it's true. So
assume that they...
But he's making a more fundamental argument. He's saying that humankind does not organize itself that way. That there's enough barriers that, that you know, the moral choice, if you will, of, you know, me acting to do all of that tends to sort of, tends to limit the amount of it. Because otherwise there would have already been a lot of it.
So let's assume a government then, which would have the reason, the motivation to potentially do
something. Do they do all that now? I mean, the strategic communications propaganda arm of the Pentagon costs something like $6 billion a year.
But has anyone done it through you? In other words, government versus government using WikiLeaks is
a sort of... We don't care if it's true.
As a laundry.
Like if it's true information, we don't care where it comes from. Let people fight with the truth, and when all the bodies are cleared, there'll be bullets of truth everywhere.
Then that does take your editorial capacity just back to verification.
Right, because it's different than just saying we'll publish everything.
It's still a slippery slope.
No, I think it's not at all. I think it's the whole intent. Let people fight with the truth. I mean,
but they have to have, the argument is they have to, there has to be a choice algorithm. You have to have some way of knowing that you're dealing with a legitimate source. Right.
No, I understand that, but that's why the ecology
can choose the publisher.
Right, but that's why the ecology is biased against any society where you can't verify. Then those people are left on their own. WikiLeaks can't help them. WikiLeaks just says, when you get a good verification system, then we're good. Otherwise, good luck.
Well,
whatever.
They're verifying documents, they're not verifying
but you have
facts.
No, they're verifying sources.
We don't verify sources.
It's not just
we verify
the revolution that technology generates noise.
The documents are official documents.
Right, they're going to be faced with more noise in the future. And the question
you
do
part
isn't whether human beings prefer truth over fiction, but whether or not they can find the truth.
But it's also not verifying facts.
But that's the core question.
It's not about verifying facts.
Right. Well, that's me. That's another argument.
We have published.
It's about verifying documents, not verifying truth. Exactly.
We have published all the fake documents that we have received that were interesting. We published saying that they were fake,
like wiki forgeries.
But it's not that many to bother with. But because they're not fake. In a meta level, they are true forgeries, right? So
they're
very, very interesting in and of themselves. And so one was attempt to influence the Kenyan election by saying that the opposition had signed a secret agreement with the Islamic minority to introduce Sharia law across Kenya. Sounds ridiculous, but actually it was carefully constructed.
So how do you know if they're forgeries?
Well, that one was hard because that was actually... That was a carefully constructed document. We checked signatures and we found the real one. That was hard work. Usually it's not hard work. Usually,
but it requires human capital to do it, right?
Usually someone makes an elementary mistake. And there's also incentives for giving us... It's pretty disincentivizing to send us a forgery. Because we're perceived as being quite good at detecting them. And we make the whole document public. So why wouldn't you just give it to a newspaper? They don't make the document public. And you're dealing with people who don't have expertise in that domain. It's a lot easier to overcome them. But anyway, this bigger issue you're talking about of, let's say you don't have authenticators like us. And authentication is hard. We can't authenticate the amount of material we're getting in. So we have thought about ways to deal with this, of having a great big mesh of people and information flowing through it and different people adding their authenticators to it as it flows through and trying to somehow to distribute and delegate that. And that might pan out. But what if everyone was simply just publishing? Everyone was publishing anonymously and you had no authenticators. What would happen? Well, to begin with, you just have a flat structure. Right, it's a completely flat structure, information there, let's say it's all just addressed by hash or something. So you have this, no structure at all actually, this document, there's that document, there's that document. And so you'll have people who want to influence making robots that put a whole lot of garbage everywhere. But it's not tied into any structure. So actually, how does anyone get to anything? Do they hear it from their friends and they go and look at it? They link it into their web pages.
It creates an influence graph of one kind.
Yeah, so there's some kind of influence graph.
Yeah.
that you use to get the information. So you can flood the internet with information. That doesn't mean you're going to flood the influence graph with information. That's something that's different.
That's the modern story of ranking. I mean, you know, the web is full of spam, but spam gets ranked low because of the influence and link structure and so forth and so on. I think we should see if we can finish up.
Okay.
As the sun is coming on out.
How do you know if you've won?
5-1.
At least that's the best question of the day.
Yeah, how do you know if you've won?
It's not possible to win this kind of thing. This is a continuous striving that people have done for a long time. Of course, there's many individual battles that we win. But it is the nature of human beings that human beings lie and cheat and deceive, and organize groups of people who do not lie and cheat and deceive find each other and get together. And because they have that temperament, are more efficient because they're not lying and cheating and deceiving each other. So that is an old, very old struggle between opportunists and collaborators. And so I don't see that going away. I think we can make some significant advances, and it is perhaps it is the making of these advances and being involved in that struggle that is good for people. So the process is in part the end game. It's not just to get somewhere in the end, rather this process of people feeling it is worthwhile to be involved in that sort of struggle is in fact worthwhile for people.
Satisfyingly spiritual.
You obviously thought about this a lot. Let's add them back.
As we're walking, got a Maoist and say continual revolution.
As we're walking in, can I ask you one last question that I was sort of wondering about on the way, which is that Scott talked about the subculture that's developed around all this, which is a really interesting idea for us to explore in the book, because it raises this question of, does the subculture create the demand to the creation of the technology, or does the technology in fact create the subculture? It's sort of interesting cause and effect.
I think, you know, you can argue this from both sides, but I think the technology emits the subculture.
So like, by
once you have a whole bunch of young people who can communicate their ideas and values freely, then culture arises naturally. So, and that culture comes out of, yes, it comes out of experiences and harmonizing with other cultures and stuff already in the record, but it also just comes out of the temperament of young people. The desire to find allies and friends and share in a process and to remove power from old people.
Sorry, you're exceptional.
Yeah, but
it's remarkable how uncreative old people are.
Speaking as an older person,
I speak. I speak as one as well.
But I think part of your intellectual argument is that you start off relatively. The model you're using, the Stanford model, you start off with sort of human values, and then they get co-opted, if you will, my word, not yours, with this sort of status model. You know that you're sort of forced into the structure of
yes.
that. And that the incentive system and constraints sort of put you into this box as you get older, and that's sort of
right, exactly. Right. And with different systems that potentiate different ways of transmitting wealth or communicating values or making some types of group cognition more efficient than others.
Right. And you're arguing that if you get enough of this sort of this group that you're identifying together, it in fact is a summary change in these complex
yeah.
systems.
Right. It'd be interesting to see whether we have a bit of some sort of state change as well.
Yeah.
I mean, revolution is a big state change, like everything was in this state and then it collapses into another state.
Yeah.
So, and those transitions happen very quickly. It'd be interesting to see whether we will have a broader general globalized cultural change that has this fast transition. It's possible.
Yeah. One thing I have learned is things happen fast because of globalization.
Right.
Right. Because everything's interconnected.
Yeah.
Didn't used to be true.
So information, money, involvement. Yeah. I mean, that's one of the. I mean, the big issue with globalization is that you can be an arsehole and move your money elsewhere. So fast EFTs, fast wealth movements, fast signing of contracts, which are a type of wealth movement. These encourage opportunism, because if political sanction, if money can move faster than political sanction, then you can just keep moving the money through the system and getting and growing it as it moves through the system, have it become more and more powerful, and by the time the moral outrage comes to stop it, it's too late, it's gone.
Sorry.
So what's happening now on the internet is that political sanction. By political, I mean the way Australians use it, by the way, which is, it's not about
Is that Australian?
It's not about party politics. It's just
the body politics.
The body politics. So, political sanction is now able to move a lot faster than it did before, and possibly as fast as money. Not in any individual transfer, but in the complex structuring arrangements you need to make transfers. These can take a while.
Let's everybody ready?
Let's move on.
Okay.
You can think of another question, Eric.
Oh, yeah, I have lots of
Julian, you've been so generous with your time.
Really appreciate it.
Do you have a bracelet?
I do, on my leg.
Yeah.
It's not a bracelet, it's a manacle.
A manacle?
Good conversations do tend to go on. And just out of curiosity, so as you get ready for this sort of next court thing you have to go through, unfortunately, the legal team comes over and visits.
Well, it kind of come over every day out here from London.
But
I did 8 hours traveling today. Actually, I fired part of my old legal team.
Yeah, I just saw that.
Because
you end up like on the phone a lot.
Well, what ended up happening is that they were charging, after promising not to, £730 an hour to sit on that train coming out from London.
But
I was rather unhappy about it.
But at the end of the day, do you end up having visitors every day, basically? Or is this relatively...
It'll be my staff or
so
on. Yeah. More interesting visitors every week or something.
Okay. Well, I hope we have been at least a distraction from all that.
So we wouldn't mind a leak from Google, which would be, I think, probably all the Patriot Act requests.
Yeah, which would be
depends on jurisdiction.
We are a U.S.
There's higher laws, First Amendment, you know.
I've actually spent quite a bit of time on this question because I am, I'm in great trouble because I've given a series of criticisms about Patriot 1 and Patriot 2. I think they're because they're non-transparent, you know, because the judge's orders are hidden and so forth and so on. And the answer is that the laws are quite clear about Google in the U.S. We couldn't do it. It would be illegal.
So we're fighting this case now with Twitter. We've done three court hearings now, trying to get the names of the other companies that fulfilled the subpoenas to the grand jury in the U.S. Twitter resisted, and so that's how some of us became aware. They argued that we should be told that there was a subpoena. I wasn't told. But this is
concerning you.
Concerning personally. But three other people. But we know there's at least four other companies.
I can certainly pass on your request to our general counsel.
Tell them to argue that we should be told.
So your specific request is that Google argue legally that WikiLeaks as an organization should be informed.
Or any of the individuals.
But the individuals, if they are named in a FISA.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I will pass that along.
Great.
and we'll see what comes back.
And tell them to bring back all the other ones as well.
Into the restroom. Why don't we all sort of figure out what we're going to do next in a minute? But let's let Julian get back to actually running the
Yeah, empire. No, he's good.
The other thing is, in terms of running WikiLeaks, I keep asking.
I'm just curious. Running WikiLeaks, are you able? I mean, you have a staff, right? So you have to talk to them.
Yeah.
You have to call them, and yep. I mean, I assume you could do email and all that. No.
I don't use email
because it's bugged.
It's too dangerous. And encrypted email is possibly even worse because it's such a flag for endpoint attacks. It's like, attack that endpoint. That's there, it's an encrypted. But we do have encrypting phones, and unfortunately, they don't work in all countries. But the SMSs work in all countries.
So but when you speak with a staff member, it would be typically on the phone or in person?
Typically in person.
Typically in person, you'd ask them.
I've kind of gotten like Osama bin Laden now.
How big is the staff?
It's about 20 people.
Yeah. But roughly then, if I were to describe it, people come and visit, you're using technology carefully to manage things, and you're well aware of people watching you and so forth.
Yes.
Yeah. And that's been true for a while, I think, in reading about it.
It's not that's been true for at least a year and a half. Well, there's been various times. I mean, one of our people was ambushed by a British intelligence in a Luxembourg car park in 2008, early 2008. So that was the first
What did they do?
Concrete. They followed him there to a supermarket, and when he came out of the supermarket, they were waiting by the car, and said, man in his 40s, nice watch, confident, tall, you know, James Bond, very stereotypes of a character, good shoes, and started to ask questions about WikiLeaks and me, and told him it would be in his interest to come and have a cup of coffee and chat about things. But it was a clear threat that it was a supermarket car park. He could have made that approach somewhere else. It was made in the car park of the supermarket.
Did he identify himself as British intelligence?
No. Mm-hmm. There's no one else like that who would be interested. And he was told by our guy that our guy wasn't interested in me. See you later. Sorry, buddy.
How do we get the beginning part of what you have on tape to transcribe? How would you like us to?
Well, we should.
Do you want to? How should we? Because he was kind enough.
Hey, we should give it to you. Might give it to you now. Might be safe.
If you don't mind, and then we'll transcribe and send it all back to you. Can we just FedEx you?
Yeah.
Yeah. Is that safe?